Welcome to Atlanta Fulton County Stadium in Atlanta, Georgia, where today the 17th-rated Clemson Tigers, 8-3, meet the 18th-ranked Baylor Bears, 7-4. It's a sellout crowd of better than 55,000 on hand to watch the 12th annual Peach Bowl.
The 1979 Peach Bowl.
Everybody, I'm Gary Bender along with Sonny Jurgensen. As we head into New Year's Eve, we have a good one shaping up for you. Two fine defensive teams. Clemson has given up only 8 touchdowns this year. Baylor allowed only once to have more than 2 touchdowns in a game.
Two contrasting styles defensively too, Gary. One team, the Baylor Bears, they play a 4-3 defense, the type of thing we're used to seeing in professional football. And the 52 defense played by Clemson, the thing that I think going into the game, I would think have to think that Baylor had a little advantage because Clemson isn't used to playing against a 4-3 defense.
At the start of this year, I doubt either team thought they'd be in postseason play. Baylor was coming off of a 3-8 record, and Clemson had lost 15 starters.
I think the big improvement, the reason these two teams are playing in a bowl game is that both of them solidified their offenses.
Now, Baylor lost their 4 games, but all 4 of their games were to top 10 rated teams. They feel this team's as good as that 74 Cotton Bowl team. Let's look at some of the principals. At quarterback for Baylor is number 7. He's Mike Granite. He's 6'3", 180, a freshman from Lake Jackson, Texas. He took over in the 6th game for the injured Mickey Evam.
He has great quickness, calmness, and the ideal temperament to be a great quarterback. He shows you his running ability there. And right here, he shows you that he does have the ability to throw the football, which he hasn't done a lot of this year.
Their number 1 rusher, number 34, Walter Abercrombie, who gained 886 yards. He's from Waco, Texas. He scored 7 touchdowns.
You would have to say that Abercrombie is a complete running back, a tough inside runner, good outside runner, a good blocker, receiver. They call him, the coaches, the complete back. And you see here a burst of speed and a big gain for the Baylor Bears.
Defensively, second team All-Southwest Conference pick tackle Gary Don Johnson from Tyler, 6'4", 260.
He's the leader of that defensive front four. Great size and strength and quickness. He keeps those people off of this young man right here.
And what a man he is. Mike Singletary, the consensus All-American, a junior from Houston.
Enthusiasm, plays with reckless abandon, and so much intensity that at times he wears himself out.
Leroy Jordan said, well, he compares very favorably to me. Grant Taff is the dean of the Southwest Coaches Conference. Let's look now and see what he has to say.
The 1979 edition of the Fighting Baylor Bears are extremely close to my heart. They were a group of young men that went through a lot of adversity in 1978, set some extremely high and far-reaching goals as a team and as individuals, and have worked extremely hard to accomplish those goals. The opportunity to play Clemson in the Peach Bowl is a culmination of all of that hard work and goal setting. And I've coached for a number of years, and I've never been prouder of a football team than I am this group of young men.
The Fighting Bears of Baylor University.
See the bear? Was that Daisy May or Abner?
Daisy May and Abner, two of the mascots for the Baylor Bears. As this sellout crowd, a better than 55,000 on hand for this. For Baylor, their first winning season since 1976, their third since 1963. They finished fourth in the Southwest Conference with a 5-3 record. Their last appearance in a bowl was 1975, the Cotton Bowl. So the Clemson Tigers coming in here, making their third straight bowl appearance. They had a senior class that in 4 years won 30 games. Let's look at one of those seniors, running back Lester Brown from Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. He gained over 1,000 yards as a junior.
And they call him the rubber duck because when he runs, his head bounces up and down. But when the Clemson offense is effective, Lester Brown is the reason. He is the back they need to have a big day to win this football game.
He missed 3.5 games due to injury. And the quarterback is Billy Lott, who started every game, a senior from Jessup, Georgia.
In his first full year after playing behind All-American Steve Fuller. This young man had a lot of pressure on him, and he did everything the coaches asked. He ran the ball club. He ran the ball well when he had to carry it. And you see right there, he has the ability to throw.
Defensively, the leading tackler, linebacker Bubba Brown from Houghton, Tennessee, 210-pounder.
Over 500 tackles in his career. Right here makes a great defensive play, deflecting the ball and knocking it to his teammate, Jeff Davis, who runs it back for a Clemson touchdown. 47 will be around the football.
A consensus All-American to tackle Jim Stuckey, 6'5", 241 out of Casey, South Carolina.
What can you say? He does it all. He's going to be a number one pick in the pros. Big, strong. He dominates that defensive line, controls the line of scrimmage, makes great plays all over the football field.
He wants to be the best in the country. He's near the ball on every play. One of 12 finalists for the Lombardi Trophy. Coach Danny Ford is 31 years old. Let's hear what he has to say about the Tigers.
Well, we felt like we had a pretty good year.
And so, at the center of the field, the acting captains for Clemson and Baylor. Our referee will be Raymond Bauer, as we will have the flip of the coin in this 12th annual Peach Bowl. The temperature, the mid-40s. It's been an overcast day, but it has not rained. The field was covered, and of course, we're playing on natural grass.
Yeah, this field doesn't drain very well either, Gary, and footing could be a problem a little later on. They have had some rain here. It isn't raining at game time, though. And boy, you can see, look at this. Who is the captain? Where are they, huh?
The enthusiasm, the tri-captains for Baylor. You see Keith Bishop, Singletary. Let's go down to the field now, and Raymond Bauer.
Captain Locke, Captain Brooke, Captain Singletary, Captain Bishop. All right, the other officials today, starting on the left, Joe Carroll, the line judge, Joe DiRenzo, the back judge, Jim McGuckin, the linesman, Foster Gross, the umpire, Jack O'Rourke, the field judge, and Massey Clarkson is our clock operator. All right, you're the home team, you're the visitor. Call it in the air. If I miss it, we'll throw it again. Because ahead, it's ahead, you've won it toss. He wants the ball. Which way do you want to go?
We'll defend this guy.
All right, spin around this way.
And as you can see, the Baylor Bears have won the toss. They have elected to receive. Sonny, we might mention, you might have noticed, at the center of the field, the Baylor players wearing number 23, they have that on their uniform, and we'll be developing that story further. It's a teammate, Kyle Woods, who is on the sideline. We'll introduce you, but if you're wondering why the 23 is on all of these Baylor players, it's in tribute to a sophomore defensive back who was injured at the start of the year. And you can feel the electricity here in Atlanta, Fulton County Stadium.
I was just thinking, Gary, which would you like to have? Would you like to have the strength of your football field, football team on the field at the beginning of the game? Because Clemson will have. They will go with their defense. It could be an advantage having lost the toss.
Clemson, remember now, has given up only 8 touchdowns, 92 points for the year. So their strength for defense. And to kick off will be Obed Ariri. He's quite a young man from Nigeria. The all-time leading scorer for the Clemson Tigers. He is number one. He has hit his last 10 field goals in a row. To give you an idea how effective he is as a field goal kicker. As the Baylor Bears will go back with 3 men. Philip Ward will be joined by Vic Hines. And also back will be Dennis Gentry.
What? As one thing to think about, coming into this game, the last time, as you look at that number 23 towel right there, neither team has played in 5 weeks since their last football game.
Ariri is ready. He was an outstanding soccer player for Clemson who finished in the finals, the championship final, finishing second. The kickoff will come to Vines. Vic Vines will bring it out to the 15, to the 20, out to the 27-yard line, and the Baylor Bears will set it up at that point. And let's check now offensively, Baylor. There is Gentry, not a very big fullback.
Not a big one, but he makes things happen. Abercrombie, the back to watch all day. Outstanding running back.
And Radar Holt. And there's the tight end, Cockrell. Marshall, he'll alternate at one of the wide receivers. And up front, Billy Glass, an all-conference performer.
I know his daddy well. He used to hit me often.
And there is Mike Brennan, the freshman, who took over in the sixth game. He's going to throw on first down. Intended on the far side for Holt, but overthrown. And that does not surprise us because Grant Taft told us they would come out throwing on first down quite often.
They want to throw on first down, and the thing they do on first down, and all the time that they throw the football, they don't go for the short throw. They go for the long pass.
Now we have a change in wide receiver. Gordon Marshall comes out. Robert Mitchell replaces him. Mitchell is 6'6". He's a sophomore out of Houston, Texas. A big offensive line for this Baylor team. They are much bigger than Clemson. Second and 10 from the 27. The throw again is Brennan, and he's in trouble. Getting through was Durham, along with Jim Stuckey, the two outstanding defensive tackles for the Clemson Tigers.
You can take a look at it right here. The left end, Ray Brown, and number 83 was the man that went in for that sack, an All-American on everyone this year. Jeff Davis and Bubba Brown, outstanding inside linebackers.
And that secondary, it's very active back there. Varn is an All-ACC pick. Mike Fisher now has checked in at wide receiver, as we now have long yardage to go. And this time, Abercrombie is hit by Ray Brown, a freshman out of Warren, Georgia. One of the most sought-after freshmen in the country. And Ron Stowe will have to come in and kick for the Baylor Bears.
You can see the swarming defense of the Clemson Tigers right here. Ray Brown playing off the block, making the tackle, a lot of help from his friends very quickly. Everybody around that football right there, Ray Brown.
Hollis Hall goes back deep for Clemson to kick the football. Ron Stowe averaging 41.4. So on a 4th and 13, he got it very high. This is Hall at the 30 and hit immediately. Excellent coverage that time. That was Scott Smith, the sophomore from Dallas, Texas, a backup strong safety who was down there instantly for the Baylor Bears. And at the 30-yard line now, Clemson will have their first offensive opportunity of the afternoon.
Well, having the fact that they'd lost the coin toss and had their strength on the field, they turned it over just as they wanted to do.
A 47-yard kick. We'll be back in just a moment. That Cotton Bowl tomorrow will be a lot of red and white. Lindsey Nelson, Paul Horning will be doing that one. Billy Lott to throw on first down. He hits Galliard. Galliard across the 40 to the 45. First down for Clemson. And McElroy over to make the stop as Galliard, a sophomore out of Yuma, Arizona.
A little hitch pattern. Lott goes back, sets himself well, throws it, and then he breaks the tackle of Collins and breaks up the sideline and picks up a Clemson first down.
How about that? Both these teams come out throwing on their first offensive play of the game. The ball at the 47-yard line. That's Perry Tuttle in motion for Clemson. Lott giving up the middle. Marvin Sims hit by Lester Ward as he's inside the Baylor end of the field. And there is that offensive team. Sims, a big fullback, weighs at 235. Brown, been hurt a lot this year, but still had a good senior year.
Yes, he has. And you see the receivers right there. Tuttle, Gaylard, they caught that first pass.
Second down, 6 yards to go. Operating now from the 49-yard line of Baylor. Lott off to Lester Brown. He may have gotten a yard, and that's all. Good coverage that time. Coming up was Ken Griffin and also Doak Field.
And Doak Field makes an excellent play here, Gary. Watch him come over the pitch back to Brown running wide on the pitch. You see the good pursuit that time. Excellent pursuit, and also Kenny Griffin there to jam it up, turn the play back to the inside.
They didn't get anything on that play. It'll be 3rd and 6 now for the Tigers. No score, just underway. Lott. He has Galliard again, and that'll be a first down catch. Just outside the 35-yard line, Kirk Collins, the left side cornerback. Sonny, you look at this team. Lott only threw the ball 140 times the entire regular season.
On both passes, he's been right on the mark. He hit the men right in the numbers with it. I think he feels more comfortable when he is moving. Most of their passing attack is rolling out, and you see how accurately he threw the ball. Again, the second reception for Jerry Gaylard.
He had 17 catches in the regular season to play. Lot on first down. This is Lester Brown. Brown to the 35. His forward progress inside the 30 before he goes out of bounds. Mike Singletary, the consensus All-American middle linebacker, runs him out of bounds, and Clemson is on the move. Let's look defensively now at Baylor.
Thomas Brown, Campbell, and Gary Johnson really do a job keeping the people off of Mike Singletary. Mellentree, excellent pass rusher.
And look at that linebacking core. They're all juniors. They'll be back another year.
Well, can you imagine? There's the secondary. Collins, Fields, Griffin, and McElroy.
They're a yard short of the first down. Second down, a yard to go at the 28-yard line of Baylor. This is Sims trying to pick up the first down. Joe Campbell, first to get there, the big junior, 225-pounder. And let's see, in fact, if Sims did get the first down. You know Sims, Sonny, carried the ball 313 times in his career, and he was stopped for a loss only one time.
You got to be kidding. Just one time, no loss?
He's quite a player out of Phenix City, Alabama.
Well, he came close to it then because Joe Campbell got good penetration that time over Jeff Bostic. Bostic has made quite a transition this year because he's moved from center to right guard, and I think that has helped this football team offensively this year because they had some question marks going into the season.
Well, as you can see, they are just short of the first down. It brings up a third down. And so they're going to bring in their short yardage guy by the name of Jeff McCall. He's a freshman from Fayetteville, North Carolina. He has been used all year long, and I think that shows great confidence in a first-year man on short yardage play.
Well, when you're 6'3", 225 pounds, you can understand why.
They come into the power eye. Third down in a matter of inches. And Lott is going to try to get it himself, and it looks like he has. Billy Lott making it straight ahead.
This is kind of a fool's you play because they bring in all the big power backs and then the quarterback sneaks it. Good smart play that time.
Billy Lott's from the hometown of Jessup, Georgia. Good friend of yours.
Yes, he is, and he's Len Hoss, the big center and the great center that played with the Washington Redskins, has been quite an inspiration to this young man.
First down at the 26-yard line for Clemson. Not on the option, and he's not going to get rid of the ball as Joe Campbell was there. Excellent play by Campbell. Baylor has four good defensive tackles. They will alternate them throughout the course of this game.
Well, this is a problem I felt that they would have because the center would have to reach block over there this time to get Campbell because the guard, Jeff Bostic, was pulling, and the center wasn't able to make the block, Mark Thornton, and Campbell makes the play behind the line of scrimmage.
From Cuero, Texas. Second down, 12 yards to go. Loss of two. Lot to throw. He's going to run it. And he is hit hard at the 30 by Andrew Mellentree, the second team All-Southwest Conference defensive end, who they think could be an excellent pro linebacker.
Yes, he's also a great pass rusher. That time it looked like Billy Lott was going to have some running room. His receivers were covered well. Take a look at it as he goes back, kind of rolling left in his pocket. Looks like he's got some daylight up front, but Mellentree very quick coming back in, making the play. I don't think Lott saw him.
They lose some more yardage. It's third down now, 14 yards to go. There's either Daisy May or Abner, we're not sure which. Play action by Lott. He's hit by Mellentree. Mellentree, who this year had 20 tackles for a loss, just added another one.
Well, they like this. They say he's their best pass rusher, and he comes from the blind side, which is a bad thing when you're talking as a quarterback standpoint, because he never saw him. Another sack for Andy Mellentree.
They call him Tree, as you might suspect, and now to come in and kick the football. This is going to be David Sims, who was fourth in the NCAA this year with a 44.4 average. He's angling for the corner. And let's see where they're going to mark it. The official running up the field. Sims didn't get what he wanted on that ball. Looks like they're going to mark it in the vicinity of the 15-yard line. And so Baylor, who has excellent defensive effort from Mellentree, has stopped Clemson's first offensive thrust of the afternoon. No score, 9:42 to go, first quarter. What a basketball game that's going to be. The Celtics against the Lakers on the 13th. First down now, Mike Brennan rolling out for Baylor. Intended for Abercrombie at the 22-yard line. That's a tough pass, Sonny. A right-hander running left to throw.
I never called it. I couldn't throw it. That is so difficult for the right-hander rolling left and going to the wide side of the field. That's the reason for the call. He gets some time, but he gets up under his blocker there, Dennis Gentry, and he can't make a very accurate throw that time and kind of overthrows Walter Abercrombie.
Abercrombie, by the way, only had 6 catches during the regular season of play. Bo Taylor checked into wide receiver. Give to Abercrombie. And he runs out of running room. Running to the short side of the field, Jack Kane, the free safety, who only weighs 170 pounds, came up to knock him out of bounds.
Well, you see some great strength in Abercrombie right here. Not a lot of running room. Good pursuit by the Clemson team. See right there, missed tackle, he gets out of bounds, runs out of room because that's, when you consider that hash mark, only 53 feet, 4 inches from the sideline. Not a lot of room to run over there.
Abercrombie, in his first game ever, got 207 yards. That was as a freshman. This time he's thrown for a loss. Eddie Gathers, cornerback, number 49, was up there, and he's excited. He's out of Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. He's a junior.
Yes, he does. They run the same play. They pitch it back again. Again, trying to anticipate Clemson playing the wide side of the field. They don't. You see the quickness of that Clemson defensive team. Gathers comes up and makes a stop.
Ron Stowe out of Houston, Texas, a freshman, kicking the football. Another good one. Hollis Hall at the 36 of Clemson. Hall trying to get outside. And he is down short of the 45-yard line. Good reaction again by Baylor. And Clemson now will get their second opportunity. That was Buzzy Nelson who snapped the ball, the sophomore center from San Antonio. One of the big surprises this year for the Baylor Bears. That was another fine kick of 48 yards. Two excellent kicks now by Ron Stowe.
But in both possessions, Clemson's had excellent field position where Baylor has started deep in their own territory. Clemson starting right at midfield.
They're going to mark the ball at the 43. Billy Lott. Play action, good faking this time, and he has his man. The far side, Kirk Collins making the stop. The catch is made by Mark Clifford, the big tight end, a senior out of Miami, Florida.
Again, Lott throwing the ball on the move, the bootleg type action, and he throws it very accurately right around the arm. Boy, he makes a good throw that time to get it around the arm of the linebacker that time, Doug Field.
You know, Lott threw only 4 interceptions this year, and that was the lowest of any starting quarterback in the ACC. 971 yards on the year. Second down, a short yard to go. At the 43 of Baylor, Lester Brown, and he has a first down. Inside the 45, Allen Tree and Singletary, and there's the Clemson bench. That's Kane, number 12, who made a fine play a moment ago on Abercrombie.
Well, those coaches are still coaching, doing their work right here. They're trying to keep him in the right position to make the play defensively.
Clemson is not as big, Sonny, but boy, they are an emotional football team.
Emotional and quick. They beat you with their quickness.
First down, the ball at the 45 of Baylor. No score. We have 8.5 minutes to go in this first quarter. Lester Brown again. Brown for a 5-yard pickup to the 40. Doak Field, a junior out of Burnett, Texas, over to make the stop. You don't hear a lot about Doak Field, but one reason is he's playing in the shadow of Mike Singletary. There's Grant Taft, 8 years, the coach of the Baylor Bears. He's the dean of the coaches in the Southwest Conference.
Well, what a nice man.
Isn't he? I'm impressed with both coaches and very much impressed with these young football players representing both schools. Second and 5 now from the 40. Lott, this is Tuttle. Tuttle has a first down catch. And he's to the 30-yard line. Kirk Collins, and Lott now has found something that's going to work.
Boy, Billy Lott has come out here throwing the ball in his first quarter. Again, the setup, a high percentage type pass, and a good run by Tuttle after the reception again. Lott, I think, is perfect. Has he missed anything yet?
Boy. This Perry Tuttle had 28 catches. He's the fastest man on their football team. He's a sophomore out of Winston-Salem, North Carolina. First down at the 30-yard line. Clemson again hammering away, getting the good field position. Lott keeps the football and gets nothing because Gary Don Johnson, number 76, who, by the way, is a cousin of Earl Campbell. In fact, they played on a state championship team in high school out of Tyler, Texas.
Now, what he was honorable mention All-American his sophomore year and had a knee injury last year and missed the season. He's back this year, and I think he's back to full strength again. Quite a nice young man. Really has a good time playing the game of football.
Second down, 10 from the 30. Tuttle split to the bottom of the screen. Lott has his man open. Russell Brown. Brown to the 10, to the 5, to the 3. First and goal. Ken Griffin, the strong safety, made a touchdown-saving tackle.
Well, well-conceived play this time. A check down by the back. Goes back looking left. All the receivers clear. Get the linebackers out of there. And just a little dump over the middle to Lester Brown. Makes a good run after catching the football. Down inside of the 5-yard line. First and goal for Clemson.
And Billy Lott is really doing a job. He is 6 of 6 in this game now for 86 yards. First and goal at the 3-yard line. Brown, very close. Andrew Mellentree, number 89, stopped him from just making it into the end zone. Second and goal there. Thomas Brown, also a senior from Galveston, Texas, was in on the tackle.
I would have to think that Baylor coaching staff and players have to be very surprised at Billy Locke's ability to throw that football the way and accurately as he has.
Second and goal. This is Brown again. Touchdown.
The same power eye formation. The back just leading it in the hole. And Brown goes over the top. Breaks the plane to that goal line. Gets in for the first touchdown of this 12th annual Peach Bowl game.
Lester Brown had 5 touchdowns rushing in the regular season of play. Ariri will attempt the point after. This guy has been outstanding. He's hit 13 of 14 PATs this year. And Ariri hits it high and through. And the Clemson Tigers, at the 6:04 mark of this first quarter, have jumped up on top 7-0. Riding the arm of Billy Lott, 6 of 6, a 57-yard drive. There's Danny Ford. He has to be happy about the way Clemson has done it thus far. As Billy Lott, 6 of 6, there's Grant Taft. I just wonder if he figured they'd come out throwing that much.
I don't think so, when you consider the fact that both Clemson and Baylor both were running teams. That's what got them here to the Peach Bowl, and they both come out in this first quarter throwing the football.
Ariri again will kick off. His longest field goal of his career, 57 yards. He added the point after. As back deep, we have 3 men. Dennis Gentry is the middleman. Philip Ward and also Vic Vines are back deep for the Baylor Bears. He's kicking away, and that ball is going to go out of bounds. Vines, the closest man to it, and so they'll be kicking it over. That ball, they're trying to kick it away from Gentry in the middle. I believe, though, Sonny, one reason Herrera does not kick off a lot is he does have the tendency to move the ball left or right instead of hitting it down the center.
Well, they're kicking from the hash mark, the left hash mark, which is kind of unusual, too. And I think they'd like for him to, maybe they plan on trapping the runner back into the corner here, because he is an accurate kicker. He shows you that with his stats kicking for field goals. Maybe they want him to kick it down in that corner.
Interesting now, Baylor has moved Dennis Gentry into the corner that they've been trying to kick the ball. A 5-yard penalty moves the ball back to the 35-yard line.
Gary, one note on that touchdown. That was Lester Brown's 32nd touchdown, a new school record for Clemson.
Boy, if he'd have been healthy all year, what would he have done? We mentioned Gentry's back there this time, and he's going to bring it out. And he'll be at the 20-yard line, and that's all. Very good coverage that time by the Tigers. So Baylor trailing 7-0, just inside 6 minutes to go in this first quarter. There was that drive. It didn't take him very long because Lott was throwing, and they were going out of bounds all the way down the field.
And the big play to Lester Brown, the pass coming out of the backfield that took it down inside of the 5-yard line.
We have a change at center. Keith Bishop, number 54, is at the center spot. He was to start the year. He was a preseason all-conference pick. He got hurt and didn't play the entire year. Here's Mike Brannan carrying the ball. Brannan has 5, maybe 6 yards. Ray Brown, again, a freshman out of Rome, Georgia, making the tackle for Clemson.
Watch Brannon this time duck under Jeff Davis coming through right here. He ducks under number 45, Jeff Davis, and makes a good. He could have been trapped for a loss.
Going to bring up now, second down, 5 yards to go. Robert Mitchell, 6'6", has checked in at wide receiver. Brannon on the second and five, giving up to Gentry. And Gentry is close to the 30-yard line. Charlie Bauman, the middle guard, and Ray Brown in on the stop. Everybody remembers Charlie Bauman in the Gator Bowl and the altercation he had with Woody Hayes as Billy Lott. Boy, he has to be smiling.
He certainly does. What a good start he's had here in the Peach Bowl. 6-6, did you say?
Mike Lively, 35, checks in. Two tight ends come in. Cockrell along with Houston. Third down, 2 yards to go. That is Lively, 35, a freshman out of Waco. Brannon on the option. An excellent play by David Reed, a senior from Radford, Virginia, and they're going to have to get rid of the football. They didn't fool anybody on that play.
Well, they haven't. Great defense, hallmark of this Clemson team. And boy, look at him. Number 90, David Reed, a 6'2", 209-pound junior from Radford, Virginia.
He had 15 tackles for losses this year and just added another one to his total. And so Stowe, who has kicked very well for Baylor, will go back inside his 20. Hollis Hall, the deep man from Seneca, South Carolina, and there's one of the fans here as we come to the close of this 1979 year. Low kick. Fair catch called for by Willie Underwood. He has it at the 37-yard line. So Clemson has a 7-0 lead. They have possession of the football.
Good smart play that time by coming over and cutting off that low kick, because if it hit the ground, it could have rolled a long way.
Well, we're down now to two teams in the NFC, and Tampa Bay, boy, did they look good against Philadelphia.
Well, huh? Congratulations to that fine staff of John McKay's and the job they did, and also the Rams.
Don't forget, it all begins on Sunday with the NFL pregame show. Billy Lott on first down, giving up. And that is Tracy Perry, the backup fullback out of Roxboro, North Carolina. Lester Ward and Andrew Mellentree making the stop, but a pickup of 6.
They have been throwing on first down. What do? They come back and run the draw play. Good smart call and good piece of running by Tracy Perry then.
Perry, by the way, after the injury to Lester Brown, ran both tailback and fullback. He's done a very good job. He's gained over 350 yards. Very versatile performer. Tommy Tabor and James Rowell have checked into tackles for Baylor. And a good play is made by Singletary. Boy, was he in there in a hurry.
He came on the blitz that time, anticipating the pass, and really makes a play this time. This is what he's done all season long. You see him coming, defeating the block, coming right over the top. Lott didn't have a chance to do anything with the football.
That's going to bring up third down. Now 7 yards to go. Singletary, by the way, averages 17 tackles a game.
What do they say? He plays so hard that he just plays himself into exhaustion, and they have to take him out and rest him.
He's a 224-pounder out of Houston. Lott, by the way, now has a minus 13 yards rushing. A good pressure put on him. Third down and 7. Mellentree, he gets away from him. And Tracy Perry could not hang on to the football, but I don't know how Lott got away from Mellentree on that play.
Boy, he made a good escape that time to get that pass off. Threw the ball to Tracy Perry, just couldn't quite hang on to it. He would have had enough for the first down.
And here's David Sims, a junior from right here in Atlanta. As we said, fourth in the NCAA, not only in average, but net average. Big rush. He just got it underway. There is no flag on the play. Sims hits the deck, but there'll be no roughing the kicker. And this time, Baylor will have good field position as David Sims almost had that kick blocked.
I don't understand why no roughing the kicker. He did not take any extra steps, his normal steps. They run into the kicker here and actually knock him down. Knock him down that time. Ray Smith was the man that knocked him down.
And so Baylor, for the first time, with a good field position just inside the 45 of Clemson. And it's a 7-0 game in favor of Clemson. 2.5 minutes to go in the first quarter. Mickey Elam is the quarterback. Elam in place of Brannon. Mickey Elam is the senior from Irving, Texas, who started the first six games. Then he had a severe hip pointer and lost his starting job to Mike Brannan.
So much of their offense is predicated around the option, taking the read on the defensive lineman. They play the quarterback that they feel that is making that read the best, because they have a zone option and a lead option. The quarterback has to be able to make the read correctly for them to be successful.
Gain of 1 yard, second down and nine. Elam rolling out. Intended on the far side for Robert Holt, and he was undressed over there by Willie Underwood, a junior from Fort Payne, Alabama. Underwood played that as well as you can play it.
Just excellent coverage that time by the Clemson secondary.
This Clemson secondary allowed only three touchdown passes all year long.
They do a lot of different things. I was surprised at the number of different coverages that they go into.
Third down, 8 yards to go. Mitchell split out along with Robert Holt. Mickey Elam to throw. Pressure put on. He gets it over to his tight end. That is Raymond Cockrell. Cockrell's inside the 30. That's a first down and a big play by Mickey Elam.
Both teams now have been successful with a little check down pass. Clemson did it to Lester Brown. This time it goes to the tight end, Raymond Cockrell, and he runs with the football after he gets it and picks up a Baylor first down.
Elam is limping. He's coming off the field, and Brannan has replaced him at quarterback. That was a 13-yard pickup to the 29.
Elam really took a shot after releasing that pass.
Here's Brannan picking to Gentry. Gentry having trouble. I believe Baylor has recovered their own fumble, but they've lost yardage all the way outside the 45.
Let's take a look and see if we can't pick up exactly what happens. Reverse pivot, the pitch back on the option play. Had it out a little bit too far in front of him at time. Just coming back in on the field. Brannan just returning to the game because of Elam's injury. Made a bad pitch at time, and Gentry couldn't come up with it.
That was a 17-yard loss all the way back to the 47. Second down. Brannan still in at quarterback. Holt. Holt to the 20-yard line. Radar Holt. Make that Bo Taylor. Correction. There's a flag as Bo Taylor knocked out of bounds at the 16-yard line. And we're going to have a penalty against Clemson. Bo Taylor, a senior from Dallas. You see what he did on the year. 8 catches.
Take a look at it. An excellent throw this time. The corner pattern. Just as Brannan releases the ball, he gets hit by Stuckey. He makes a good throw. He gets up slowly. You see Taylor take the ball in, goes out of bounds, and you're going to get a late hit on Eddie Gethers.
And so the penalty will be stepped off. That pass moving the ball to the 16-yard line. Baylor down 7-0, 42 seconds to go in this first quarter.
So we're going half the distance.
Let's listen.
And half the distance.
Correct.
Personal foul signals.
That's two penalties, Sonny. Two penalties, so they'll go the half the distance on both penalties.
Two dead ball fouls. Both against the Orange.
Bubba Brown, number 47.
Distance. We're going to need a new ball. Let's see, this is a 5, 10, 60. We're going to the 8. 8. Good ball. Another ball.
And now he's going to do it again, Sonny. See? Half the distance again.
Okay.
There you go.
Now we're going to be.
You're going to see what happens right here. You take a look at it.
Let's go back and look on replay and see what precipitated all this.
You see right here, getting knocked out of bounds. Terry Kennard knocks him out of bounds, but then Eddie Gathers comes in and hits him very late. Picks up the personal foul penalty. Here you take another angle from it, and look how far he's off the white stripe before he takes the blow.
It's Bedlam here. You can hardly hear yourself think. First and goal at the 4-yard line. Lively in motion for the Baylor Bears. Brannan on the option. Hit immediately by David Reed. Boy, is it noisy. It's got to be hard for them to hear the snap count as they're going right into a lot of those orange-dressed Clemson Tiger fans.
That Clemson defense is not going to make it easy for Mr. Brannan to get into the end zone either. He ducks in right there, and look how many people around that football. David Reed, Jeff Davis, Jim Stuckey, everybody around the football.
Second and goal at the four. Travis Self, Raymond Cockrell, two tight ends are in. There's Brannon asking for quiet. Pollard is in the backfield. He cannot hear, and I can understand why I can't even hear, and we're a long ways from where they are. And Grant Taft, I'm sure, very pleased that Brannon did show at least some poise to quiet it down. And so we're going to return as the first quarter comes to a close.
That's a night that the lights went out in Georgia.
Well, Sonny, we had the time run down during that last play, which indicated the first quarter had come to a close, but the officials during that last break have put some time on the clock. In fact, they put about 25 seconds on it, and they started it up again. There it is running. So this will be the last play of the first quarter. Second and goal at the four, Lively in motion. Brannon trying to take it in. And the Tigers are just playing a swarming defense at the goal line. Jim Stuckey, number 83, and you're going to hear his name a lot. And that will be now the end of the first quarter as Clemson leading 7-0.
Well, they show you their quickness right here. And, of course, as we said at the top of the show, Jim Stuckey, the All-American, made the play right there. Such great quickness he showed right there, moving laterally and making the play, stopping it for no gain.
Well, Sonny, tonight on CBS, look at the lineup, would you? WKRP in Cincinnati. I guess Dr. Johnny Fever will hear the voice of God in that one.
Oh.
Then on to the last resort. Michael and Gale, like a quiet weekend. MASH, they have an abandoned baby on their doorstep in that particular episode. And then the new comedy series, House Calls, followed then by Lou Grant, Ed Asner on CBS tonight.
What a nice lineup for New Year's Eve, huh?
That's right. Bring in the new year the right way. Now there's the Clemson Tiger. So much color, so much excitement. As we mentioned, it is really noisy here in this stadium. Second quarter underway, a big play coming up. Third and goal. The ball at the 3-yard line, and Baylor now is going to re-huddle there again. Had a lot of problems with the noise.
I think they went to the line of scrimmage, Gary, but the officials have not arrived. You see them coming into the picture now. The officials had not arrived with the football. You got to have that pigskin to play with.
There's Mike Brannon. This young man showing good poise. He was a redshirt freshman. Excellent runner. He had 120 yards rushing in a game this year. That was the second highest ever for a Baylor quarterback.
At practice, we saw Baylor practicing a little motion and throwing a pass off of this at this particular part of the football field. It seemed they have, go to it at third and three.
They have Bo Taylor in there. Third and goal at the three. Brannon. And he has his man on the far side, and Bo Taylor for the touchdown. Taylor with two big catches on this drive. And now with a chance to tie it up, the Baylor Bears.
Good throw this time by Mike Brannon. Shows you his poise right here. A little turnout pattern. Throws it very quickly. He beats Terry Kennard for the touchdown. 1 foot in bounds in college football. We have a touchdown. And we are very close to having a tie football game.
Bo Taylor had one touchdown catch in the regular season. Robert Bledsoe will come in to attempt the point after, a junior from Stanford, Texas. He hit all but one of his PATs. Grant Taft with a sigh of relief as his team now has tied this game up. Bledsoe adding the point after. And so with only 5 seconds gone by in the second quarter here in the 12th annual Peach Bowl, we're all even at 7. A little liquid refreshment.
Can you believe that? Look at him holding that thing up there and drinking it.
I tell you what, it doesn't take him long to empty the contents of that bottle.
Boy, would that be a commercial?
7-7 our score. Carlos Alvarez will be kicking off now for the Baylor Bears. Andy Hedden and Chuck McSwain back as the twin safeties. Make that Lorenzo Alvarez. I think I said Carlos. I'm from the 40. Alvarez, he kicks off in favor of Bledsoe, who does the point after. Here's Hedden. He's a freshman. And Hedden brings it out to the 10, make it the 12-yard line. Howard Fields down there. And I'll tell you, Sonny, Baylor just isn't getting those kickoffs back up the field at all.
Now they're not, but that time, I tell you something, Baylor kicking the ball down in the corner just like Clemson did, and they kicked it down in the corner and trapped him in the corner. I thought he was going to let the ball go out of bounds. It looked like it may have gone out of bounds. And
Hedden, by the way, was a highly sought-after player out of Liberty, North Carolina. He eventually could be their quarterback.
This is the worst field position that Clemson has started with all day.
At the 13 is where they mark it. Tuttle goes in motion. Watt giving up. Mike Singletary making the stop. As Lester Brown, does Brown get off the mark quickly? He really comes up to that line of scrimmage.
Well, he does, but Baylor has in their other, you're looking at the scoring drive there, but Baylor has in their second line of defensive tackles now, Tommy Tabor and James Rowell, and they did an excellent job that time in freeing Singletary up to make the tackle.
Also should mention that Max McGarry is also checked in at a defensive end. He's number 99 for Baylor. Second down, eight, a pickup of two by Lester Brown. Lot on the option. Off to Brown. Brown is close to the 20-yard line. Lester Ward and Singletary over there.
Boy, Lot did a good job that time on the option play. He pitched it right at the last second, giving Brown an opportunity to turn upfield with the football, get his shoulders turned up, get some running room.
The thing about this Clemson team is the fact that not only do they have Lester Ward, but they are Lester Brown, but they have a guy by the name of Chuck McSwain who can come in.
There's the paw, the tiger paw, huh?
Boy, that's a trademark of this team. Lot on a third down and three. Oh, as he hit Ken Griffin, a senior out of Athens, Texas, a strong safety. He really came after him on that play.
He got outside of his protection that time. You see Singletary coming over, Doak Field forcing air, Ken Griffin. And you see number 63 again around that football. Came a long way. Billy Lott ran out of things he could do with the football.
David Sims, who almost had one blocked a moment ago, will kick again. He hits it badly off the side of his foot. And Sims is going to get a roll, however. And it's going to make it across the 50. But both of his kicks, I'm sure he is not pleased with. But he got a good roll on that one.
Again, close to being blocked. They're putting a lot of pressure on him. Maybe bothering his timing a little bit on the punts.
38-yard kick. They mark it at the 50-yard line. Baylor, Clemson, all tied up. 7-7. We have 13:05 to play in the first half. Sweet Georgia Brown. The NBA on CBS. Been very well received in our first two telecasts. The third one coming up January 13th. From the 50-yard line, Brannon back to throw. He's hit. And he has his man, Robert Holt. Holt has the catch to the 21-yard line, and Baylor striking quickly for the first down.
That's the same pattern that they threw earlier to Bo Taylor. Goes back the corner pattern, and he was under a lot of heat when he delivered the ball. But a good catch this time, coming back, making the catch. A little bit underthrown, but Robert Radar Holt, they called him.
28-yard pickup. Holt and Taylor very active in this first half of play.
Well, Brandon's done a job since he's come back in also.
A little mix-up now. Looked like Arlen Thompson, the left side tackle out of Plainview, Texas, moved before the snap. Thompson and Barnes, by the way, they consider them the best pair of offensive tackles the Baylor's ever had at any one time.
You can see they just blew the count. You'll see the movement right there. That little false
illegal procedure. 51 offense. First down.
Arlen Thompson.
So it'll be first and 15. Mark Kirchner is in place of Bill Glass. Glass had some ankle trouble. He hurt an ankle working out for the Peach Bowl. He did start the game. Here's Abercrombie. Abercrombie inside the 25-yard line. Hollis Hall, sophomore from Seneca, South Carolina, over to make the stop. One thing about Abercrombie, he can run inside or out.
Yeah. Well, and they say he's a good blocker, too. He's developed into the complete back for him, and by surprise, too. They had to bring him up because of injuries. Did an excellent job last year for him, and also this year.
And the Tiger exhorting the fans, and their fans are alive here today. Here's Brannon on a second and 12. That's a dangerous pass in the end zone. It's caught for the touchdown by Robert Holt.
A desperation pass, just threw it up for grabs. I tell you, tremendous concentration that time by Holt. Take a look at it, the play design to go left. He rolls left, good coverage, goes back around. Watch your block right here. We didn't see the block. He was in hot pursuit that time. But look, everybody in the end zone taking a swipe at the ball. Underwood could not come down with it. But watch Brannon as he releases this football. He really takes his shot that time from Ray Brown.
And the point after attempt by Bledsoe. And Baylor now has a 14-7 lead, a 24-yard touchdown pass. Well, I'm sure that Grant Taft was a little nervous when he saw that ball in the airway, but it paid off for 6 points. Well, there was a drive. It didn't take very long. Brannon in this game, 4 of 5 for 86 yards in passing.
You know, they took him out to try to generate a little offense early in the game, and Elam came in and got nicked up. But since coming back, Brannon's been outstanding.
Lorenzo Alvarez will kick off again. Hedden along with Chuck McSwain back deep for Clemson. 12:20 to go till halftime. Hedden will have it at the 5. He has some running room all the way out across the 30. Had he not been tripped up by Howard Fields, you had the idea he may have been gone.
Well, he looked like he was going to find some daylight. He just got tripped up. Good athlete, Andy Hedden. Take a look at him right here. He finds a little gap to get through. He splits it. Just that one hit, if he had avoided that, he'd have gone all the way to the kicker.
Hedden, by the way, was judged by Sports Illustrated to be Clemson's best recruit. Clemson this year was rated to have the 6th best recruiting year of anybody in college football. At the 34, first down, Lester Brown. Brown to the 40, and Brown has a first down out across the 40 to the 42. Doak Field and Van McElroy combining on the stop, but Clemson with a first down run.
Did you think he got the first down? I tell you, your eyes are better than mine, Gary.
Maybe they're going to say he did not get there. Just a little bit short. You're right. Second down coming up. Looked like he had it, but he is short.
I think he may have run out of some real estate on that side.
Lester Brown now, 8 carries for 26 yards in this game. Second and a short yard. Brown again. Oh, what a hit that time by Singletary.
As he knifed through. They say he's the best in the country. His coach, he says, not enough things nice you can say about this young man.
517 tackles in 3 years. As we said, almost 16 a game. Third down, still that yard to go. Tuttle, number 22, split to the top of the screen. Sims, the lead back ahead of Lester Brown. That's Tuttle in motion. Brown diving forward, and it looks like this time he did get the first down. Doak Field, 46. Thomas Brown, number 90, in on the tackle. Brown, a real workhorse in this game. He's already carried the ball 10 times.
I think both of these teams have surprised us somewhat in the first half with the ability to throw the ball. They've had trouble running the ball. The big plays have been by the pass.
Fourth or first. I'm going to quit guessing on these first downs. I thought he had that one, too. I'll never say another time that he has a first down.
You were right.
That's twice for McGuckin. Now, that's it.
And so the ball at the 43-yard line, 14-7. Baylor on top. The Tigers jumped on top, 7-0 at the 6:04 mark of the first quarter. And it was tied up the first play of the second quarter, and now it's 14-7 in favor of Baylor. Billy Lott. And down he goes, Mellentree there to get him.
They're just having a difficult time. Lee Nanny having an impossible time trying to block Andy Mellentree. Just an outstanding pass rusher. Take a look at him again as he rushes his passer. Goes back, Lott going back, never sees him. He's setting up short. Then he's going to go back and try to throw deep. By that time, he's down.
You know, Grant Taft told us he hoped that they wouldn't try to, you know, compensate for him. He thought they might use 2 tight ends that way to keep Mellentree out of their backfield.
They feel they're much more successful defensively
Here's a reverse up to Tuttle. And Tuttle gets back to the line of scrimmage and picks up maybe a yard. Howard Field, Stoke Field. Baylor had that one diagnosed.
Yes, they did. They didn't fool anybody. They pitched back to Brown. Brown handing to Tuttle, going back. But you see, he gets some fine blocks here, but he just gets back to the line of scrimmage. Maybe picks up a yard or so. We have some players down on the field. Can't tell who it is from here.
Looks like Lester Ward, a junior out of Temple, Texas. Very fine junior linebacker for this Baylor team. Very mobile. They feel he's underrated. Ward, Field, and Singletary. You have to look a long ways before you find three better linebackers than Baylor's. Now the backup man would be Steve Rinaldo. He is a senior from Littleton, Colorado, who, by the way, was born deaf. And he will get his signals from the sideline.
Well, they say he's a courageous athlete and does just a tremendous job when he has the opportunity to play. You see Lester Ward coming off the field. I said that last time that he didn't get a lot out of the play. He did get 9 yards, but he gets back to the original line of scrimmage after the sack.
There is Ward, the man shaken up. And it is Rinaldo that will come in and replace him. Just short of the 45-yard line. Third down, 9 yards to go. Galeyard is split to the bottom of the screen. Also Tuttle for Clemson. Watt hits Brown to the 50, to the 49-yard line, and Singletary. How did he get out there that quickly?
He's all over the football field. All over the football field. You see how tired he is right now coming off the field because of the effort he puts out all the time. He's just exhausted.
The football again will be David Sims. Howard Fields is back deep for Baylor on this fourth down. This time he gets into it very well. No fair catch. Was there? I guess there was. I didn't see it. Howard Fields. He just should have called for the fair catch is what he should have done on that play.
He should have. Somebody should have given him a little information about the people coming down covering that kick that time.
I couldn't believe it. I thought maybe I didn't see it. It was a 36-yard kick, and Fields really got pounded at the 13-yard line. Well, tonight on CBS, as we mentioned, WKRP in Cincinnati. We're also later going to have a special report on Iran. Hostages at Christmas. Tribute to Richard Rodgers. All tonight, right here on CBS. Here's Brannon. Giving up, and nothing developed on that play because Steve Durham, 66, and Lester should check that. Bubba Brown made the stop. That was Dennis Gentry carrying the ball, and he lost a yard on that play. Second and 11.
They have an opportunity to gain some advantage in field position this time if they can hold him right here, this particular drive.
Change of tackle. Brent Jones, a senior from El Paso, has replaced Arlen Thompson at left offensive tackle for Baylor. Also coming in, Mike Fisher. Abercrombie. And Durham is there. The junior from Greer, South Carolina, an all-ACC pick.
Well, this is what you call defeating that block. Look how quickly he's off the ball. Jones tried to block him, tried to cut him off. That's his 13th sack. You want to call it a sack behind the line of scrimmage, but he's made two big plays here for the defense.
He's made big play after big play for this Clemson team. He was the ACC Defensive Player of the Week twice this year. Third down. 15 yards to go. Bo Taylor, one of the wide receivers. Brannon is going to keep it. 15-yard line out to the 19. But he's still a good 5 yards short of the first down. Rex Barn made the stop, and Brannon's shaken up. They've already had Elam hurt. And Baylor could be running out of quarterbacks.
Well, they have Steve Smith, the senior that played last year, senior out of El Paso. But we, from what we understood, Elam wasn't that bad. He could return.
So they're looking over Mike Brannon, the freshman. Baylor will have to kick the football.
And Clemson,
Hollis Hall will go back.
Clemson could come away with good field position this time.
14-7 our score in favor of Baylor. We have 7:25 remaining in the second quarter. Brannon up and walking off, but limping. Ron Stowe will kick the ball for Baylor. Not a bad average, huh? Look at that.
44 yards.
The average just over 41 in the regular season of play. And he hit a very fine kick. Hollis Hall at the 34. He's trying to get to the picket line, but he's in difficulty. And he's going to lose yardage back to the 25-yard line. Baylor's Scott Smith was down there, but just give credit to the entire punt coverage team.
Exactly. He lost about 10 yards trying to get to the line, to get behind that picket line, as you call it, but he couldn't quite reach it.
49-yard kick that time by Stowe, who continues to impress in the Peach Bowl. Eighth-ranked Nebraska, sixth-ranked Houston. Tomorrow, 2 o'clock Eastern, the Cotton Bowl on CBS. There's 31-year-old Danny Ford. He took over in the Gator Bowl last year when Charlie Pell went on to the University of Florida and defeated Ohio State 17-15.
Tremendous job, tremendous pressure he had right then, but he said what he could do.
There's Galliard on the far side trying to make the catch at the 30-yard line, and he was really belted by Ken Griffin, the strong safety, an incomplete.
Again, this roll out to the left a little bit. Tough to get a lot on the football when you're throwing it, running that way. He makes an accurate throw, but good coverage that time. Knocks the ball loose. Kenny Griffin.
He's made two very fine plays. One on the run and now on the pass. Second down, 10. Lott on the option, pitching back to Brown. Down to the 35, 37-yard line. Thomas Earl Young, a junior from Houston, number 32, over to make the tackle for Baylor. And Brown gets outside as quickly as anybody.
Did he make the first down?
I'm not going to say. I'll never say it again.
Again, success with the option. Billy Lott doing a good job pitching the ball back to Lester Brown, and with his speed getting
Durham
outside and setting up like third and inches for the first down.
There's Bauman, Bubba Brown, Steve Durham. Bubba Brown, the leading tackler. Durham been very impressive in the early going. Third down, less than a yard to go. Brown trying to get it, and he's got it. Lester Brown only weighs 175, but he's doing it all. They haven't given the ball that much to Marvin Sims.
They really haven't there. High formation. They like to give it to Brown with his quickness and let him pick some daylight to run through. This Clemson team really plays with a lot of enthusiasm.
Brown last year as a junior had 1,022 yards, but he missed 3.5 games this year. A very gifted back. He started the year with flu, then he injured his ribs, which curtailed a lot of his activity. He has 12 carries now for 40 yards. Lott hit by Ken Griffin again, and I just mentioned a while ago how well he's playing. And Steve Ronaldo, 59, again now. Remember, Ronaldo was born deaf. He's an outstanding student, by the way, at Baylor.
Man, White.
He's
White
one captain. Of the very captain. Few. We have some conversation down here with the referee. Talking
It'll
to Mike Singletary.
And about 9 or 1st and 15.
There was a flag on the near sideline.
Okay.
And the penalty being explained to Baylor.
Illegal formation. Refused. 2nd down.
Illegal formation. And I'm sure that Danny Ford would like to know just what they did wrong.
You're talking about Ronaldo, Gary. He's one of the few players on the Baylor squad outside of Texas. He's from Littleton, Colorado.
They have some football players in the state of Texas,
well,
don't they?
They do. I think they have 5 out of 99 out of Texas.
2nd down, 9 yards to go. Billy Lott. Pressure put on by Brown and intended for Marvin Sims at the 41.
I think James Rowell knocked that ball down that time.
Rowell would be 97, a senior, who plays just with reckless abandon. There's Sims, 31, the intended receiver. Sims only had 3 catches in the regular season.
The reason they keep shifting defensive linemen in and out for Baylor, they like to have fresh, strong defensive linemen in front of Singletary to keep the blockers off of him.
Virtually 10 yards to go. Lots of trouble. And that is Mellentree again. And Mellentree has been all over Billy Lott.
And talking with Grant Taft earlier this week, he said, I don't think that they can block Andy Mellentry with one man. They're going to have to put two people on him if they intend throwing the football. And Lee Nan has really had his hands full in this first half.
Coke Field was coming from the other side. Howard Fields is back now for Baylor. David Sims, Mellentry putting pressure on. A beautiful kick by Sims. This time he calls for the fair catch. And very wisely so.
Exactly right.
So in the vicinity of the 35-yard line is where Baylor will have the football. So Sims, after a rather shaky start, has now started to kick the ball very well. You know, we're mentioning number 23, Sonny, and that 23 is Kyle Woods, a sophomore defensive back who's sitting on the bench. His Baylor teammates, very happy about him being here. He's a paraplegic. 1 week before the 79 season, Coach Grant tasked Bears were scrimmaging, and Kyle injured his spinal cord in a scrimmage. And they promised Kyle that the Bears would play in a bowl game and they would dedicate it to him. And that's the reason he's wearing, and the rest of his teammates are wearing, his number 23. Mickey Elam has come back in at quarterback. Brandon, we understand, suffered a bruised knee, but he may be able to continue should they need him. Jim Stuckey, the senior from Casey, South Carolina, made the stop. A gain of one, second and nine.
They've shifted some backs also this time. They have Frank Pollard in, a senior out of Meridian, Texas.
Quick glance at that number 23. Kyle Woods came in today on the plane. They greeted him out there, and this team, a very emotional team, dedicating the game to him. Second and nine, Elam. And he's trying to hit Fisher, Mike Fisher, but nothing developed on that play at all.
Well, they rotated up on Fisher that time, and very wisely, Mickey Elam threw the ball out of bounds. He just threw it over his head because the play was defeated. The defense defeated it. Hollis Hall was the man that was up on him.
Elam is better known for his running than his passing. He threw 48 passes this year, but he had 109 yards rushing against Texas Tech this year. Excellent student, almost has a 4-point grade average out of Irving, Texas. Third down, 9 yards to go. Mitchell and Holt, the wide receivers. Bubba Brown putting the pressure on, and that made Elam get rid of the football. Did Bubba Brown get back there?
That's two passes that Mickey went back to throw, and he was under pressure on this one. Watch Bubba Brown, number 47, coming through, and he does a good job just to get the ball off. Could have been intercepted. Fortunately for Baylor, it wasn't.
This young man has been all ACC the last 2 years. 140 tackles. Ron Stowe to kick from the 20-yard line. A low kick. Hollis Hall is going to let it hit. Now he comes up. And Hall will be dropped at the 26-yard line. Again, very good coverage by Baylor, and in particular, Ray Smith, a junior from Dallas whose daddy was quite a football player. James Ray was All-American at Baylor and then played with the Cleveland Browns. Well, Tuesday night on CBS, we'll start with a white shadow as Coach Reeves is accused of pushing amphetamines on the Carver High squad. That's Tuesday night at 8, 7 Central to Mountain. Then Jack Lord leads the Hawaii 5-0 team through a tough final exam. And then James Earl Jones battles a syndicate on Paris. Lester Brown, Joe Campbell having a collision with him, a gain of 1 yard for Clemson. We have 4 minutes remaining in the second quarter. 14-7. Baylor with the lead after trailing early in the game 7-0.
That was Thomas Brown on the tackle that time. Gary Brown blocking on Thomas Brown.
Had a little battle on the sideline here.
You better watch out there.
Tuttle in motion. Lot to Brown. Brown across the 30 to the 35. Very close to the first down. Doak Field wrestles him down.
That's the third time that Lester Brown has taken a play running to his left, picking up about 10 yards, and each time he runs right to the yard marker. I think that's the third time he's been right at the yard marker.
Doak Field, you don't hear a lot about him, but he's made a lot of tackles in this game. 3-year starter, very consistent. He calls the defensive signals. Runs a 4.8 40. As you can see, they're just short, third and about a yard, and Brown takes again over the middle for the first down. He's going outside. He's going inside.
He's piling up some yardage, too, here in the first half, carrying the ball as many times as he has.
Number four all-time rusher for Clemson. 2,182 yards coming in here. As we mentioned, he has 32 career touchdowns. Thus far, he has 52 yards on 15 carries. On the first down, that's Tracy Perry, senior from Roxborough, North Carolina. Gary Don Johnson making the stop along with Singletary. Forward progress to the 40-yard line, second down, and still 8 yards to go.
It seems that Lester Brown is the only one having any success at running the football for Clemson.
Tuttle will be split to the bottom of the screen. There's that fight still going on the sideline. Well, who's winning that one? Billy Lott on the option. Nice cut by Lott. And he'll make it to the vicinity of the 43 and a half. Singletary and Ronaldo. I tell you, Sonny, I can't get over how many reads an option quarterback must make.
He has to make them so quickly, too. He's reading the block of his offensive tackle, whether the tackle is taking his man outside or inside, and then he has to make the decision there to give the ball to the fullback, keep it himself, run with it, pitch it back to Lester Brown. So many different things he has to do.
Third down, five. Tuttle, Galyard, the two wide receivers, Lott. Galyard, the intended receiver, he cut inside and the ball was delivered outside. And David Sims will come in and kick for Clemson as Howard Fields will go back. A little mix-up on that play.
I think so. That was the first bad pass Billy Lott has thrown in this football game when he's had time to deliver the football. That time a mix-up in the pattern.
And so Sims to kick from the 29-yard line. 1:28 remaining at halftime. We'll be introducing you to the athletic directors, the presidents of the respective universities. Looks like a little illegal procedure against Clemson on that play. That'll be 5 yards.
Yeah, you see him right there moving.
That's 54. Jeff Gandon.
Jeff Gandon moving.
Hold it, boys.
But he was reacting to the offense because the offense had moved first and the penalty goes against Clemson.
And so now Sims will be inside his own 25, as you see him. High snap. Beautiful, beautiful kick. At the 12-yard line is Howard Fields. And he'll get back to the 19. And that is the kind of kicking we expected to see from David Sims. A picturesque kick that time, a distance of 50 yards.
You have to be impressed with both of these teams having a 5-week layoff, the way they have executed here in the first half.
Well, the NFC Championship from Tampa Bay, the Rams, the Buccaneers, it all begins with the NFL today with Brent Jane Irv, Jimmy the Greek, and Jack Whitaker.
Boy, two surprising teams. I don't think many of the experts figured that these two teams would be in the championship game.
Mickey Elam still the quarterback on the option. Drop for a loss.
Guess who? Number 83, Jim Stuckey, the All-American Clemson defensive tackle.
Stuckey and Durham inside are causing this Baylor line fits.
Well, watch him come around. He's trying to get by him so he can option the ball. He doesn't get a chance to because of the quickness of Jim Stuckey.
They say he just dominates the line of scrimmage, and that's a good example of it there. He wants to be near the ball on every play, and he wants to be the best in the country, and he's close in that goal, I would think, very quickly. Elam giving off to Gentry, and boy, there's just nothing developing on this series. Stuckey again on this tackle. One-man show right now, and it comes to a third down, and Clemson is going to call timeout. They want to get the football as there's still 31 seconds left in this first half as we have a third down coming up.
It's difficult to pick a side you want to run at when you're running at that and facing at Clemson defense because Steve Durham is on the other side and we've seen two great plays by him already. Difficult to pick which side you want to run at.
Well, Clemson this year was third in the nation in scoring defense, giving up 8.4 points a game. Only Alabama and Texas had better marks. And as far as rushing is concerned, Sonny, they were holding teams about 115 yards a game. This has been a very enjoyable 3 or 4 days here in Atlanta. The Peach Bowl committee and all the help they have given us. The cooperation has just been outstanding. Very much impressed with the organization and the sellout crowd here in this 12th annual Peach Bowl, and the color and excitement as you look at Lester Brown, a fine running back for the Tigers. Well, you have a third down, 13 yards to go, 31 seconds left. Clemson figuring to get the football before this first half is over. Frank Pollard has now checked in. Walter Abercrombie has also joined him in the backfield. Elam, the quarterback.
Boy, you saw that list of all Southwest Conference players there on the Baylor team.
Elam gives to Gentry. Gentry back to the original line of scrimmage, and that's all. Steve Durham and Clemson again will ask for a timeout. So there's now 25 seconds left, and they figure to get good field position.
Well, the whole difference in this first half so far, Gary, has been the busted play. Brannon throwing the long pass on a busted play, getting a touchdown out of it.
Hollis Hall will go back for Clemson. He'll go back to the 50-yard line. Stowe, who's kicked very well for Baylor, will have a pressure kick coming up. You see the time remaining.
Clemson has not tried to block a kick yet. They've had the return on each time. Let's see if they go after this one.
They have only one man back. Here they come. Boy, they hit him, and they're going to have roughing the kicker on that. Hollis Hall inside the 35-yard line. He'll be dropped, but Baylor will have the football as Stowe was roughed. He is down, and he's not getting up very quickly.
They went for the block here. This time the kicker does get knocked down. They call the roughing, and boy, does he ever get hit this time. And he is hurt. He's still down on the field. Let's hope it isn't serious.
That was a 47-yard kick under some less than ideal situation.
It looks like he's getting up. He's going to be okay.
Stowe has replaced a pretty fair kicker this year, Luke Prestige, who moved on and did such a good job for Denver. There's Stowe.
Out of Houston, how many players did they say come out of, like 44% of the football players or something come out of Houston, Texas?
And he came out of the same high school that Luke Prestige did out of Houston. Danny Ford, he's not happy about that roughing the kicker because that takes Baylor out of a very, very precarious situation. Gives them first down at their own 34-yard line with 16 seconds. Elam gives off to Pollard, and Pollard, who missed a lot of this year with a broken jaw, moves it out to the 38-yard line. Ray Brown, Steve Durham make the stop, and we're going to have another timeout. This time, Baylor stops the clock with 4 seconds left.
Maybe they're going to throw one up again long.
One of those Hopper-type passes, right?
Both of these teams, Gary, capable of running a lot of people at it, at you, keeping fresh backs in the game. And that's important when you play with the intensity that both teams play with.
You see Mitchell, 81, the biggest, should say the tallest man on this Baylor team at 6'6". Danny Ford, he's going to have people backing up a little bit in that secondary. Get them back about 20, 30 yards. Be sure they don't get one behind them.
Yeah, they're going to give up anything short. They just don't want to give up the home run.
At halftime, we're going to have the Baylor and Clemson bands. We saw them in the pregame, and they are impressive. And we'll be watching them. We'll be visiting with a guy by the name of Frank Howard from Clemson. And we'll also have Jack Patterson, the athletic director at Baylor.
I was just looking around for Frank to see if he were going to make it to the booth.
Elam gives to Gentry, and that is going to end this first half of play. So the Baylor Bears, after trailing early in this game, 7-0, have come back to score twice. And at halftime, they lead 14-7. What a halftime we have in store for you as coming onto the field, the Golden Wave Marching Band of Baylor University. Dick Floyd, the director of bands and assistant professor of music education at Baylor, a 200-member band, and let's listen. We'll be right back. Broadway band performed in 9 football games during the 79 season before 500,000 Southwest Conference fans. Enrollment is currently limited to 220 members, and all the positions are subject to audition. See some of the enthusiasm here. More than 20,000 fans coming from Clemson, which is about a 2-hour drive from the Atlanta area, and Baylor, not to be outdone, they had over 10,000 loyal fans coming here to the Peach Bowl. Feature number by the Twirlers, the Saints Fight, and then they'll have some of the music, old Baylor Fighting Line, a lot of color and tradition here. They're making their 10th appearance in this 1979 season.
Hit half
time at the Peach Bowl, the 12th annual Peach Bowl, are two gentlemen from Clemson University. One has been there 1 year. Another gentleman right here, probably very recognizable, has been at Clemson 44 years. A lot has taken place in those 44 years, Frank Howard.
Well, there's no doubt about that. You've even graduated from Duke University, and that's a lot better than Bear Bryant did at Alabama.
They've done an excellent job with this football team, coming back a rebuilding year, yet they come back and make their third straight bowl appearance.
Well, we got a fine football coach. We also got a fine president in Dr. Atchley here. We got a fine school, got a fine athletic program, athletic facilities, everything about it. It's the best, honey.
I have to ask, Dr. Bill Atchley, in your first year at Clemson and coming in there, from what I can see, Clemson is going after national recognition.
Well, I think that's true. We've had a great tradition. Frank and all the people before me have laid a great foundation, and what our philosophy will be that whatever we do, let's be number one in all of it. And I think that as long as you have those as your goals, you'll always strive to go forward. And I think with the type of athletic program and such we've had, the academic programs, we've got a high-quality all-around program, and I think you're going to see a lot more out of Clemson in the future.
Where did you come up with this tiger paw idea? Everybody, we see tiger paws on people's faces, all the fans of Clemson.
Well, I think Frank could probably answer that better than I could, but as I understood it sometime back, there needed to be an identity. We are a state-supported school and a land-grant university, and so they brought in an advertising group to try to find out some way we could bring an identity. They finally decided they'd work with the athletic department since they'd already had a great tradition and some exposure, and they came up with the tiger paw, and it's been a great thing for us ever since, and we're going to continue making it great.
What about the goals of Clemson University in the 80s?
Well, I think the goals will be that we will continue to strive to maintain a high-quality education and also a great athletic program, and like I said before, we'll be number one in all of them, but I think you'll find Clemson University will not be the ivory tide type of university. We'll be working for those type of problems that the world needs to be solved, and we're going to be working on energy and other areas, and I think you'll see a tremendous feat over for Clemson in the future, and we'll make these problems in the world, I think, seem small.
Thank you, Doctor. Coach, I know you'd like to be down in that dressing room. Thank you for stopping by, and good luck to Clemson, and continued good success. Gary?
Okay, Sonny, we have a halftime score here of 14-7 in favor of the Baylor Bears. Throughout the course of this halftime, we'll get to see the Clemson marching band. We'll also visit with Jack Patterson, the athletic director of the Baylor Bears. We'll be back with more action from the 12th annual Peach Bowl after this word from your local station. And now, performing at halftime, the Clemson University Band, the Tiger Band, the director, Dr. Bruce F. Cook. The Tiger Band, the official marching band, consists of 195 members, including a flag corps. And this band performs at football games, basketball games, parades, pep rallies. And its members come from all departments of the Clemson campus, from agriculture to zoology. Time, we'd like to introduce you to Jack Patterson, who is the athletic director at Baylor University. He took over that position in 1972 after an outstanding career as a track coach. And Jack, we were just remarking at the top of the show, I don't think a lot of people in Waco or possibly in the Texas area thought that Baylor would have a postseason game after going 3-8 a year ago.
Of course, I think this year we're just enjoying the results that we hoped for a year ago. So naturally, this is quite pleasing to us.
I'm very impressed with the players, the coaches, the way they've conducted themselves. I get the feeling there's a very close-knit group, Grant Taft and what he's done.
Well, I, of course, personally like to feel that we have a little more of a family atmosphere all through our athletic department. First, because of the size of our school and the beliefs that we have that make them very important to us.
As you look at these young men, we were just remarking of the players that have played today, all but one are from the state of Texas.
Yes. The bulk of our players do come from the state of Texas. Naturally, if we find a good one any part of the world, we're ready to talk to it.
As being a former track coach, I know you're very much aware of how this conference has improved with its quickness, its speed, the attributes that you would be very much aware of.
Yeah. Certainly, we're finding fellas today that are 6'5 and weigh 250 that could do things that the youngsters that were 6'1 and 195 or 205 could do years ago.
Jack, what about the decade of the 1980s? You've had success here in football. This is the next bowl appearance since 1974. What do you want to have happen, not only football-wise, but the entire athletic program?
Well, naturally, we're striving for academic excellence at Baylor University, and I would certainly hope that our athletic department in all phases would keep pace, and we're striving for excellence and recognition in the athletic program and everything that we do.
I was very much interested in one of the starting guards for Baylor, Billy Glass, an all-conference selection, and his daddy, I guess, here, Bill Glass Sr., watching the game. He was an all-pro, and Sonny remembers him only too well in the pro league.
I can be sure that he does, because I've had two stays at Baylor University, and Bill Glass was one of the fine players at Baylor when doing my first day. Now it's especially makes me pleased to have his son playing for us at the present time.
Jack, thank you, and a happy new year, too.
Thank you very much, and so do you.
Jack Patterson, the athletic director at Baylor University, is our halftime continuing here as Clemson, their band, performing before the sellout here in Atlanta Fulton County Stadium. And in the first half, they witnessed a game that I think surprised some people. They opened up the game early. Both teams came out throwing the football, with first Clemson taking the lead 7-0 at the 6:04 mark. And then Baylor came back to score twice in the second quarter, and they now lead it 14-7 at halftime. Sonny, I have not been disappointed at all. I think both these teams have played well. I've been impressed so much with the linebacking play, of both teams, and what pass pressure. Melendez will kick off, Hedden and Chuck McSwain, back deep for Clemson. And again, he kicks it to the corner, and they're gonna go out of bounds with it. That will be a 5-yard penalty. The entire game, they've had difficulty getting that football in the field of play.
Well, they have, both teams have kicked the ball with their sidewinders, kicking the ball down in the corner, and I think they're doing it purposely, and that time he got a little bit too much hook on it, and it got out of bounds.
Bob Rowe, our producer, indicates that Mike Brennan, the young man, the freshman quarterback, will not return to the game. He has injured his knee, and so that means that Mickey Elam will have to be the man.
From what I understand, it's stretched ligaments, and I see standing on the sidelines right now, that man will not be back, but Steve Smith,
this time from the, excuse me, Sonny, this time from the 35, Alvarez to kick, Hedden and McSwain again deep. This will be Hedden again at the 11. And Hedden is rammed out of bounds as he comes across the 25-yard line. That's Parker coming over. This Hedden kid, a big kid at 6'5", returning at. And so the Tigers, who started out effectively, especially because they had the good field position early in the game, and then they lost it.
Very true. Baylor defense did a good job in that second quarter. After trailing, they started digging in. They adjusted to the Clemson offense. Did an outstanding job.
One reason Baylor had the field position was the kicking of Stowe in that second quarter. Lott on first down. trying to hit Tuttle on the far side, and that'll bring up a second and 10.
As in the first half, they come out throwing the football, trying to throw on first down, and a little offense going.
Again, Sonny, I'll say it, that's a tough pass for a right-hander.
Well, they're throwing the wide side of the field, Gary, and that's why they do it. They want to have some room to throw the football.
We have Gary Brown, Jeff Bostic, Mark Thornton, Chris Dolce, Lee Nanny, the offensive line. As Galliard's in motion, up the middle comes Tracy Perry. And Perry out across the 35 to the 36. It'll be a third down. Steve Ronaldo, who's playing in place of the injured Lester Ward, makes the tackle.
This was a good read by Billy Lott, electing to give the ball to Tracy Perry. Found some daylight, breaks up the middle. Third and about one.
You know, the mystery to me is why Marvin Sims is not carrying the ball.
We have not seen a lot of him, and starting in the second half, Tracy Perry is playing in his place.
Third down, 2 yards to go. Lott to Brown. And Brown gets the first down. Disappears before that Baylor bench. Doak Field and Ronaldo combining on the stop, but Clemson with the first down.
Boy, he breaks a tackle here by the big defensive end, Thomas Brown. Look at Brown right there. Almost got caught for a face mask. And who comes over? Steve Ronaldo with a little help from Kurt Collins.
From the 41, first down. 14-7, Baylor. The first time these two teams have ever met. Billy Lott to Galliard. And he has a catch inside the 50, very close to the first down. Ken Griffin over to make the stop.
Again, rolling left to throw the football. A lot of room to work with over there, and he throws it on the move, and he has Galliard wide open. And it's very close to the first down, about a half a yard to go. Clemson on the move, huh?
This young man's from Yuma, but he grew up in high school in the state of Alabama. So really, he returned home, or near to home anyway, to play for the Tigers. On a second down, a short yard, Tuttle. That'll be a first down catch. Kirk Collins defending on the play. Boy, they opened it up a little bit, didn't they, on a second and less than a yard, and came out throwing.
As they have an unusual call in, throwing the ball on second and very short, unless you're going for the home run, because if you incomplete the pass, you got to come back third and very short. Makes it a little more difficult.
The Tigers on the move just inside the 45 of Baylor. We're just underway in the third quarter. Lott to Brown. Brown to the 40. He might break it. A touchdown saving tackle by Van McElroy. McElroy 16 was all that stopped him from going all the way.
Baylor had everybody up near the line of scrimmage, about 10 men near the line of scrimmage defensively that time. Lester Brown found some running room. You take a look at this, a lot of people coming across, and just as he splits it, he's wide open, and that was a touchdown saving tackle. You can see how many people up there. Good block that time by Gary Brown on Thomas Brown.
Back to live action. That was a 16-yard pickup. Here's Lester Brown again. Inside the 25 to the 22. Singletary made the stop. We had a new man in that time, Frank Magwood, a freshman out of Johns Island, South Carolina, number two, at a wide receiver in place of Tuttle.
It looks like Clemson has made some adjustments offensively. They're finding a little daylight. Maybe they change their blocking schemes a little bit, but they are moving the football now.
Thus far, Lester Brown has 77 yards on 18 carries. Second down, 5 yards to go. Marvin Sims is now checked in at fullback for the Tiger. And Lott keeps it. And a fine play by Kirk Collins, the left side cornerback. Boy, they support well, don't they?
Well, they do. Every time that Billy has taken that thing on a keeper, electing to keep it, there's the option to the fullback. He takes it back. You see the defensive end coming back trying to make a play there, but Kirk Collins comes up, makes an excellent play on Billy Lott, the Clemson quarterback.
A gain of one. Third down, 4 yards to go, 11 and a half minutes to go, third quarter. Sims, Brown, the running backs behind Lott. That's Magwood in motion. Off to Brown. Mellentree giving chase. It was Mellentree that was dragging from behind. He had support then, and it's going to bring up a fourth down. Mellentry was running and matching stride for stride that time with Lester Brown.
Magwood going in motion, actually doesn't get across, and he doesn't get out in front. He was supposed to be leading the play, and you see the pursuit. Ronaldo, Griffin, everybody out there, Mellentry, a lot of white shirts around that football.
Arere will attempt a 41-yard field goal as Bo Blanton will be holding, but wait a minute. We have a timeout call.
Well, a mix-up, got to get in the right personnel to protect for this field goal.
The Tigers calling the timeout. Now, Arere this year has hit 15 of 21 field goals. His longest of this year was 47. He's had a career long one of 57. This will be 41 yards, and he has been 6 of 6 between 30 and 39 yards.
And over 40 yards, he's 3 out of 5, so this is well within his range.
So evidently, Clemson, having all kinds of difficulties with their alignment, called a timeout to be absolutely sure they had the right people in on this very important field goal. Blanton to hold, Arere, a 41-yard attempt. He's from the left hash mark.
And this is a hash mark that a sidewinder likes.
He has enough height, he has enough distance, and he has a 41-yard field goal. So the Tigers, taking the opening kickoff of this third quarter, end up with a 41-yard field goal. It's now Baylor 14, Clemson 10. Arere's field goal, by the way, was just 1 yard short of the Peach Bowl record.
And boy, he hits it good. He really has a lot of length here. This would have been good from 51 yards.
The record was 42 yards, and it was Jay Sherrill, I believe.
That's right, 1977, North Carolina State.
How about that opening drive? Took 4:05. And that has to give Danny Ford and his offensive troops some confidence.
Kind of like a chess game. They made some adjustments, and I'm sure that the Baylor Bears will go to the bench. Their coaches will make adjustments defensively now.
Dennis Gentry is back deep as Arere will kick off. He's joined there by Phillip Ward and Vic Vines. 14-10, Clemson. Trailing as this will be Gentry. Gentry is really decked at the 20-yard line. You don't think they haven't fired themselves up a little bit after that three-pointer?
We're going to have an exciting second half. You can see that.
Gentry getting up slow. Matt Smith, a linebacker, is the guy that led the charge. Mick Elam will be the quarterback. As mentioned, Mike Brannon is out for the remainder of the game, and Elam was shaken up earlier. It was Elam who started the year as their quarterback, then suffered that hip pointer in the sixth game, and now in this Peach Bowl, he's been called upon again. From the 20-yard line, Elam, big pressure put on. Coming through was Ray Brown. Remember his name. He is just a freshman.
Boy, does he come. The defensive end on that side, number 72, Ray Brown. And he just runs right by Walter Abercrombie and makes a play on Mickey Elam.
Robert Mitchell was the intended receiver, but there just wasn't any chance on that one because of the pressure by Brown. And so, Baylor in a very difficult situation. They have Robert Holt flanked to the near side. Mitchell to the far side of the field. Up the middle. And Abercrombie is able to make it to the 24-yard line. It looked like that might develop into more. Jeff Davis, 45, made the tackle.
This is their option. They give on the read because he read the block of Frank Ditta that time, number 60. He gave inside. They pick up a big gain. It still sets up after the loss of the trap by Brown. It still sets up about 3rd and 7.
Abercrombie, the sophomore from Waco, Texas. 3rd down, 5 yards to go. Baylor needs a 1st down, and this crowd now on their feet. Elam throwing a dangerous pass to Abercrombie. That'll be a 1st down catch, and he has some running room. He's to the 40, the 35, the 30, the 20, and he's knocked down inside the 15-yard line by Rex Barnes. Barn, the all-ACC cornerback, caught up with him. And you talk about a big play for the Baylor Bears.
You talk about a dangerous play. Rolling left, throwing it back across the green, and he's throwing it running backwards, and they caught him by surprise. He beats, you see, going down the sideline, then they got a chase. Jack Kane finally run out of bounds. Boy, what a big play for Baylor. Just take a look at it again. Durham right in his face, and right here, Bubba Brown gets knocked down. Kane and chase, and then the race is on. Finally run out of bounds by Rex Barnes.
That was a 63-yard pickup. Baylor cannot hear the snap count as they back off. 63 yards that time by Abercrombie. You know, he had a 78-yard catch earlier this year, so Walter has been on the tail end of a couple of big ones. And none bigger than that as far as Baylor is concerned, because they had a third and five. They were in a bad field position situation. The momentum was on the Tigers' side, and all of a sudden, they go 63 yards.
You got to give that coach and staff of Baylor a lot of credit for that play. A very dangerous type throw, rolling left, backing up, and laying the ball up with nothing on it, just kind of lobbing it back over there to come out with that kind of play.
As you said in practice to one of those kids, you better be a good tackler if you're going to throw that very often.
Well, that's for sure when you throw that type of pass.
At the 13-yard line, first down for Baylor. Elam now, 2 of 6 for 76 yards. He gives off to Pollard. Mike Pollard, a senior from Meridian, Texas. Jeff Davis, Jim Stuckey. Pollard is the guy that broke his jaw and lost 15 pounds this year.
Look at the swarming defense. Stuckey, everybody over there. Good play that time defensively. Jeff Davis and Stuckey, the primary tacklers on the play, on the pitch.
They lost a yard. Second down, 11. The ball at the 14-yard line. 9:12 to go, third quarter. Bo Taylor has checked in. He's flanked to the bottom of the screen. Robert Mitchell at the top. Give up the middle. Pollard, and Pollard runs into a lot of orange jerseys led by Durham and Stuckey. And it comes to a third down. Good reaction that time. And look at the intensity of this Baylor Bear. That is James Rao, a backup defensive tackle.
Again, the success against Clemson and also against Baylor has been by the pass.
Mike Fisher has checked in at a wide receiver for the Bears. Third down and 9. Fisher, along with Bo Taylor, the wide receiver. Mickey Elam, throwing. Trying to come up was Raymond Cockrell, the tight end, and that brings up fourth down and a field goal attempt.
Oh, what an effort he made to try to catch that ball with one hand.
From Killeen, Texas, 6'3", 222, a junior. He had four catches as Grant Taft now will hope to get the field goal. Coming in will be Robert Bledsoe. He's 13 of 17 this year. He was a guy who missed his first five field goals in 78 and has come back this year to kick very well, as you see. And this will be a 29-yard attempt. Steve Smith to hold. It's a low line drive, but he got it. That ball didn't get up very well, but it got through there.
Got about 12 feet high, didn't it?
And so they come back to match field goal. And again, Baylor has a 7-point lead. He was shaken up earlier, replacing Steve Ronaldo. Billy Lott gives to Brown again, and Brown to the 35, where it's going to bring up third down and still 2 yards to go.
Well, he does a good job here. A counter draw play. He just gets around. Pretty good move that time on James Rowell, number 97.
And Thomas Brown eventually made the tackle, a senior. I would imagine that Baylor's glad to have Lester Ward back in there. They have all three of those excellent junior linebackers back in.
This becomes a big play for Clemson, third and two.
Third and two. Brown, and coming through is Doak Field. What a big play defensively. Doak Field out of Burnett, Texas. And that's going to set up a kicking situation for the Tigers.
Boy, Doak Field just reads the play perfectly. Couldn't have played it any better. Breaks through and throws Brown for a loss.
Again, we can't say enough about the linebacking play we're seeing in this game.
Well, you read so much about Mike Singletary, then you have people like...
There's a block kick. And it's going to be down to the 35. It looked like Jeff Gandy, 45, blocked it. He is a freshman from San Antonio. This team does an excellent job of blocking kicks. Gandy had blocked two of them earlier. And I believe that's who it is. We'll see it on a replay here. As Sims, again, just didn't get rid of the ball.
They've been very close to blocking kicks all day. Doesn't seem to be taking a long time, but boy, do they get in there. They have a lot of people that were capable of blocking that kick that time.
It is confirmed. It is Jeff Gandy that did block it. And now, at the 35, first down, Abercrombie. He's to the 25-yard line. Jim Stuckey making the tackle for Clemson.
Abercrombie running inside. Again, a good read by Mickey Elam, giving the ball inside, and Stuckey having to come across in pursuit to make the tackle from behind.
You know, Max McGarry for Baylor in his career has 11 block kicks, so they make an art of blocking kicks.
Well, it shows you what their coaching staff really works on, all phases of the football game, the special teams included.
Second down and two, and Abercrombie is going to be short of the first down by a yard as he makes it to the 25-yard line. Ray Brown again on the tackle, number 72. He, by the way, was an All-American at Parade Magazine in high school, the state lineman of the year in the state of Georgia.
And it's obvious that Baylor saw something in the Clemson kicking game that they felt they could exploit, because they have tried to block every kick, every punt today.
Phillip Ward is now checked in for Abercrombie, and Frank Pollard has also come in. A power eye formation. Third down, a yard to go. Pollard, he has a first down. And I mean, he really fired through on that play. Eddie Gathers made the stop for the Tigers. And Pollard, who's gotten a second life after missing most of the season and a chance in postseason play, to come back and do something about it.
Both teams go to this power eye formation in short yardage. They get that extra block inside there. That time, good piece of running, good line movement at the point of attack.
First down, just outside the 20. Travis Self, Raymond Cockrell, two tight ends have come in. Elam, the quarterback, on the power eye. Abercrombie cutting against the grain. He's to the 10. And that should be a first and goal. Boy, did he cut back on that play.
He did again. The Baylor line doing a good job at the line of scrimmage, and he cuts back against the grain, and you see he finds some daylight that time. Durham couldn't quite make the tackle. Finally making the tackle is Rex Barn, who comes across to make it. We told you about him. Abercrombie having the ability to run inside and outside, and you see that he's not scared of giving up his body.
Give a lot of credit that time to Frank Ditta, the left side offensive guard on the block. Here is Elam keeping the football, and Elam runs into all kinds of difficulty. Well, you try to go wide in the pursuit of this team, and in particular Jeff Davis and Bubba Brown on that play is something.
Well, I'm sure that Grant Taft would rather somebody else be carrying that football than one of the only quarterbacks he has right now since Brannon is out of the game. And you see Davis and everybody and Durham coming over, laying the wood to Mickey Elam. Only Steve Smith can come in and play with any experience.
Attendance today, 57,371. A great crowd here on hand for the 12th annual Peach Bowl. Second down from the 7. Elam throwing a touchdown catch by Cockrell. Raymond Cockrell, the tight end.
Again, throwing the football. What a job Mickey Elam does here on this play. Rolling out, running to the wide side of the field. Good pattern by Cockrell, and another Baylor touchdown.
Cockrell had two touchdown catches in the regular season of play.
You can see he has a lot of room. Cockrell just ran an excellent pattern that time to beat his man for the touchdown. And Clemson's going to have to make some adjustments defensively in order to stop Baylor.
Bledsoe, the point after attempt. Steve Smith to hold. And Bledsoe hits it very well. And it's now 24-10 in favor of the Baylor Bear. As Baylor, with Mickey Elam picking up where Mike Brannon could not continue because of injury. A very happy Baylor team, and in the background, Raymond Cockrell, the tight end, who just caught that 7-yard touchdown pass. Frank Ditta, who threw a big block sitting alongside him. And the Bears lead it 24-10 with 3:43 to go in the third quarter.
By no means is the game over with.
McSwain and Hedden back deep for this kick from Alvarez. start out the game, both of them were kicking from the hash marks. Now Alvarez teed it up in the center of the field. Hedden will take this one. To the 20, 25, and Hedden fumbled the football, and it is going to be recovered by Clemson. Boy, that could have been disastrous for the Tigers. Howard Fields is over there. Let's see if we can pick up the fumble.
Boy, could this have been a big play for Baylor? Disaster for Clemson. See, he goes down. See if we can see where they come back up. Boy, he just pulls that football back in as he's going down. Take a look at it again. Loses the ball right there. Comes out and gets a quick arm out there in a hurry to get it back.
Back to the live action. Tuttle on a pass from Billy Lott. And he's going to go out of bounds at the 36, maybe the 37-yard line.
Same pattern they've had success with, throwing to the wide side of the field, a square-out pattern. Seems that it's been there each time. Makes a good throw, good reception. Howard Fields, the coverer.
We have a couple of changes in the secondary for Baylor. Thomas Earl Young and Vic Vines have come in as keeping some fresh people in that secondary. Second down, almost 2 yards to go. Brown trying to pick it up, and he does, and he fires out across the 45 to the 47. Howard Fields, Vic Vines combine on a stop, but don't count out this Clemson team yet.
Well, they come right back at you this time. This time he cuts back in. They get a good block on Mike Singletary this time. Brown, with his eyes open, cut back inside and picks up a Clemson first down.
He now has 87 yards rushing for the day. And they're going to mark the ball at the 46-yard line. First down for the Tigers. Galyard, the bottom of the screen, flanked out as you look at the Baylor bench. 3:08 to go, third quarter. Lott falls down. Well, he was going to pass as he had Galyard over here. Also Clifford, the tight end. You ever had that happen to you, Mr. Jurgensen?
I'm afraid to say that I have. I think he tripped over Lester Brown that time. They just got their feet mixed up a little bit, and he goes down. And you don't think that's embarrassing for a quarterback?
Loss back inside to the 39-yard line. Second down, long yardage to go. Second down, almost 20. This time goes to Brown, and reaction is just excellent that time by Joe Campbell. And also Max McGeary, number 99.
Boy, time to run the draw play. No place to go. Look at this play. Excellent play that time by Campbell. No ball loss. It's going to be third and about 11.
You also saw in the picture there, Sonny, number 89. And every time you look around, you see him. This is McGeary, the man we mentioned earlier from Denver City, Texas, who has 11 block kicks in his career.
It makes an art out of it, huh?
But on third down and 20. Lester Brown, the intended receiver. That play did not develop very well.
It didn't, but Billy Lott couldn't see him, but he had Mark Clifford wide open standing in front of the Clemson bench. He may have been looking into that maze of orange and not be able to pick him out.
David Sims will kick. It's been an adventure, and there's Jack Kane. Not very happy. A safety for Clemson, and another fine kick by Sims. Howard Fields at the 11. And boy, what a kicking game Sims now is putting on. That gives them much better field position than they anticipated.
He's been able to kick it when he's been able to get it off.
That was
he's been under a lot of heat.
That was only 53 yards. I don't know what happened to him earlier. He may have had some jitters, but since that time, he's been kicking the tar out of the ball. And so the ball will be marked at the 17-yard line. Baylor with a 24-10 lead, 1:40 remaining in the third quarter. Yard line. Baylor with a 24-10 lead, 1:40 remaining in the third quarter. On the fake, tried to hit Sam Houston, number 86. Sam Houston, by the way, is related to Sam Houston, the man of historical fame.
A bootleg pass this time. You see Elam putting the ball on his hip, gets a little pressure, but he gets time to throw the ball. When he does, he just throws it behind Houston this time, or he would have had a completion.
Houston, a freshman. They spelled your name right, too.
Is that how you spell it?
They told me at halftime you graduated from Duke. What is it? Here's Abercrombie. He makes it to the 21, and it's going to come to a third down and still a good 6, maybe 7 yards to go. The Tigers need to make their move here as Ray Brown in on that last stop. Down 24-10. They'd like to hold here and get the ball with good field position. Coming in now will be Cockrell. He'll be joined by Robert Mitchell, wide receiver and tight end for Baylor. As you see Sam Houston check out.
Now that pass may have been a little too short for Mickey to throw because they like to throw the ball long. I think they average about 22 yards per reception.
Elam on third down. And he's going to be thrown for a loss. Really stuffed that time by David Reed. Reed was the man who hemmed him in. He tried to go up the middle, and all kinds of help arrived from his Tiger teammates.
And they were trying to go long that time. They had everybody running fly patterns going straight up the field. He just did not have time. As we look at Billy Lott, he's got to get some offense generated for the Clemson Tigers.
Stowe will come in and kick. He kicked a very good kick earlier in the same spot, and they roughed him. And this time inside the five, Hollis Hall is back deep for Clemson. And he hit another beauty. Hollis Hall at the 31. And he gets it across the 35 to the 36-yard line. Scott Smith again down there. He's been down on all those punts, covering very effectively for the Bears. The second half, these two guys are kicking the football.
They really are. Ron Stowe.
That was a 51-yarder, Sonny. Earlier, a 53 was kicked by Sims, and so they're kind of matching each other. The longest punt, by the way, in Peach Bowl history is 62 yards. So the ball marked at the 37. The Tigers with the ball down 24-10. Lott throwing to Tuttle. And he made a remarkable catch. That will be a first down just across the 50-yard line.
This is what you call remarkable execution, Gary. Just an excellent throw by Billy Lott because there was good coverage on the play. And you see how close it was and what a tremendous reception Perry Tuttle makes.
Cedric Mack, a freshman from Freeport, Texas, was the man who covered on the play. And so that's the end of the third quarter. We'll be back with more action from the Peach Bowl after this word from your local station.
Wednesday.
Before we start this fourth quarter, I want to thank some people here in the Peach Bowl. Tom Nicholson, Larry Croft, Coleman Meadows, Larry Bell, along with Linda Nelson, Reg McCrary, and Gordon Mann Mall, who were so instrumental in making our stay here and the information that we've needed to make this telecast possible in this 12th annual affair. And we have 15 minutes left to play in it. First down for the Tigers. They trail it 24-10. Billy Lott. Tuttle again. Tuttle breaks it to the 31-yard line. And all of a sudden, he's found Perry Tuttle wide open.
Boy, does he make a good throw here. He comes back inside. They've been running the pattern to the outside. He throws it back to the inside. And you see, he just got it over a linebacker. Look at the move that Tuttle makes. He doesn't quite escape, but a good reception, and Clemson is on the move. Take a look at it again as you see number 22, Perry Tuttle, in isolation. He comes back. Good concentration that time in making the reception.
19-yard pickup on the play. Lester Brown trying to go wide. Nothing doing. As first was Ken Griffin. Boy, they lost a lot of yardage on that play. The line of scrimmage was the 31, and they're all the way back out to the 40, Max McGarry. But it was Griffin who sealed it off. He came flying up from that corner and safety position.
They've made an adjustment defensively on this play. Clemson had some success with this play, and they just have their strong safety, number 26, Ken Griffin, firing up there now, and the pursuit catches up with Lester Brown from the inside.
Give some credit to Doak Field on that play also. Back to the 40-yard line, second down now, 19 yards to go, and the Tigers have called timeout. Clemson calling timeout with 14 minutes left in this game. They're having to play some catch-up football, but Billy Lott is airing the football out a little bit. He's found Perry Tuttle twice on this drive, and they're trying to make a comeback. We'll be back.
Well, special edition of a CBS Sports Spectacular coming up next Saturday. As we pick up the action here, we'll be talking further
about that. As Sonny will be out in Palo Alto to bring you the East-West Shrine Game. A flag on the play, two of them. Lot rolling out on a second and 19, and that ball almost intercepted. Ken Griffin defending on the play. A pass intended for Perry Tuttle.
Motion on the arm.
Okay.
Let's see what Perry Tuttle does here.
Right, Captain?
Right.
Where's the captain?
Penalty looks like it's going to go against Clemson.
You want to decline that penalty?
Yes.
Okay. Illegal motion. Offense. Refused. Third down.
Third down and still 19 yards to go.
Take a look at Tuttle here, number 22, adjusting on the pattern when they were scrambling. And boy, he does a good job there. He becomes the defender.
Joey Smith, a freshman from Newport News, Virginia, number 17, is checked in. Tiger Howdy. All right. Third down, 19. Lot needs some big yardage. He just does get rid of the football as from behind, Tommy Tabor from Calvert, Texas, dropped him. Looks like Tuttle's hurt.
Yes, it does. It looks like he got banged up a little bit on the play. See if we can pick it up and see what happens to Perry Tuttle here. Here it is. Take a look at it. See what happens to him on this play. Goes down. He's running free here. He stops. Nobody around him. Looks like he just got sick to his stomach, doesn't
he? Either that or he brushed off of that one man when he made his cut. I don't know if he caught something in the stomach or not, but David Sims will have to kick the football on a fourth down. Howard Fields back at the 10-yard line for Baylor. 13:48 left in this game. Sims trying to go for the corner. And I believe he did it. Did he ever do it? That's about the 3-yard line.
Boy, that kick puts Baylor back in dangerous territory right now. You see the congratulations to Dave Sims. And Baylor will have to be careful with the football here.
They will, as the ball at the 3-yard line when we return.
That's a night that the lights went out in Georgia.
A 24-10 lead, but they have the football at their own 3-yard line. There's Elam's statistics. The big play, a 63-yard pass completion to Abercrombie. And Phillip Ward, the running back. This is Pollard, and nothing develops on that play. Charlie Bauman, the nose guard, to make the stop for Clemson.
Well, you can believe the Tigers would like to force a fumble here, and they came very close. He did an excellent job there to hold on to the football. He was hit just as they made the exchange.
No gain, second and 10, still from the 3-yard line. Getting a little bit cooler here in Atlanta. It was the mid-40s at kickoff time. That overcast the entire game. It's still Ward and Pollard and also Lively in the backfield. And again, it's Pollard trying to get up the field, and again, nothing develops. And it's a third down coming up. And he gathers that time.
You think he'll put it up?
Well, one of our spotters, Mike Scott, who is the assistant sports information director for Baylor, shook his head yes, so we'll see.
He knows the team better than we do, Gary.
He, along with Jeff Rhodes from Clemson, who is a student aide for the public relations department of the Tigers, have been our spotters today, and we thank them. And again, it's Pollard, and again, the same result, and they're going to have to get rid of the football. That was Jeff Davis, the sophomore from Greensboro, North Carolina. And Baylor really has a pressure-packed punt coming up.
Well, they got to kick it right back from the back of the end zone this time, and it's going to be a short type of punt because they can't go to the full spread because he doesn't have a lot of room.
He can't step out of the back, or it's a safety. Hollis Hall is deep for Clemson. Oh, very fine kick. Look where he kicked that ball all the way to 47, and Hall had to fall on it, and the Tigers do not get the field position they anticipated as Stowe booted that ball 49 yards. And you're looking again at Smith, who is down covering so well on that punt.
49 yards he gets credit for, but he kicked it about 60 yards.
The kicking in the second half has been as fine as I've ever seen, not only in college ball, but professional football. From the 48 now, Clemson playing catch-up football. Lott looking, Tuttle's got it. And Tuttle is dropped at the 46-yard line. Kirk Collins making the tackle for the Baylor Bears.
Harry Tuttle back in the game. They need him for their passing attack. A little short hitch pattern. He tries to spin back out, but no place to go because that time Thomas Earl Young was right there to make the stop.
This time Tuttle is split to the bottom. Lott crosses him up, giving off to Tracy Perry, and Perry has a first down. Ken Griffin made the tackle, and that really fooled him. Good faking job by Billy Lott.
Yes, going back, running a quick draw, a quick type of draw that time. Excellent block that time on Mike Singletary by Mark Thornton, the offensive center for Clemson.
So the first down sets the ball up at the 37. Firing off the left side of that Tiger offensive line. It was Clifford, a pass intended and inflated to Galliard, but they're going to bring it back. Clifford, the tight end, fired off.
Well, they had a penalty on the play here, the same type of pattern that they had success with. They're trying to force Tom Young to come up and play that man so they can get a long one behind him, but he refuses to come up. He's playing it very well.
So the 5-yard step off for the offside.
Offsides, 81, offense. First down, first down.
Said 81, but I'm sure it's 87. Mark Clifford. So it's first and 15. Grand Tap, his team with a 24-10 lead. Tuttle, by the way, has 6 catches for 61 yards. Lott giving off, and that time Chuck McSwain was drilled by Joe Campbell. That's the freshman we talked about earlier who we haven't seen much in this game, and he loses yardage back to the 44. That's the second drive, Sonny, where the Tigers have gotten things going only to really then start backing up the other way.
Well, you have to give credit to that team right there you're looking at, that defensive unit of Baylor. They're doing an excellent job right now shutting down the Clemson offense.
Galliard along with Tuttle to the bottom of the screen. Lott to throw. He got rid of it miraculously. He hits Tuttle. Tuttle is close to the first down. Van McElroy made the stop, and give credit to Billy Lott throwing that football with somebody draped all over him.
Well, he does. As you say, rolling left. This time he comes back up, and you see Mellentree hanging all over him. He keeps his poise, throws the ball, delivers it to Tuttle. Boy, what a big play for Clemson.
Now, that was third and 17. I don't know if they got the first down.
Well, you take a look at it, a crossing pattern. He comes back, finds the open daylight inside, and he's going to pick up enough for the first down for Clemson.
You heard the roar go up. They brought the chain gang in, and it indicates it is a first down and a big play for the Clemson Tigers. They have it now at the 26 of Baylor. Look at the stats on Tuttle.
He's been outstanding today as a receiver.
They just can't cover him, can they?
Well, they've had trouble covering, and they're giving him up. They're giving him the stuff underneath and short, nothing long.
Billy Lott keeps the Tigers' hopes alive. 9.5 minutes left in the game. Gary Don Johnson wraps up that time. Tracy Perry.
They're trying to run enough to keep the defense honest, but they're not getting a lot of yards out of the running of the football.
And there is a new attendance record for the 12th annual Peach Bowl, 57,371. And they have enjoyed a very colorful afternoon.
Boy, give that Peach Bowl committee a lot of credit for promoting his football game, and what a fine one we've seen.
Second down and 7, fake by Lott. Intended for Tuttle. Was covered very well by Howard Fields, 44.
Take a look at this again. You'll see it. He's Tuttle going down, running a sideline pattern, trying to drive off Fields, coming back for the football. Almost had a shot. Ball got him back on the left shoulder. Incompletion.
There he is from Killeen, Texas. Second team all Southwest Conference pick. Super competitor for this Baylor team. Third down, 7 yards to go. And he hit his man on the near side. That's Joey Smith, the freshman. And it comes to a fourth down. They've had most of their success throwing to the right as they roll right.
Yeah, but the problem is they're on the right hash mark. You don't have a lot of room to operate in on the right side. This time, that's why they've been trying to get a completion to the left side of the field to give them some operating room to throw back there.
Well, they're going for it on a fourth down and seven. Trailing 24-10, the field goal, not what they're interested in at this point. And the Clemson crowd on their feet here. Watt with time to throw, intercepted. Picked off by Thomas Earl Young. And Young is up to the 35-yard line. Tuttle was completely surrounded by Baylor football players.
Billy Lott, facing a fourth and seven situation, was trying to make something happen that wasn't there. You can see the number of white shirts around Perry Tuttle. Nothing there, and he pays the price for it because it is intercepted.
Georgia. Georgia.
Well, Thomas Earl Young, a junior from Houston, Texas, just came up with a big interception, a 14-yard return. He was a young man that had knee surgery in the spring and has come back to play. And there they are, and lights, no less.
Well, I tell you, they did that fine, didn't they? Our producer, Bob Rowe, and Jim Silman, our fine director.
Dennis Gentry has Baylor now intent on hanging on to that football. Good reaction by Jeff Bryant, a big sophomore from right here in Atlanta, Georgia, number 99, who made the tackle. Going to bring up second down, almost 11 yards to go. Robert Mitchell checks in for Baylor. Well, the Tigers jumped up on top early in this game, led 7-0. Baylor roaring back to take a 14-7 halftime lead and then build it to 24-10 after three quarters. Mickey Elam, they're still going to throw the football despite that lead, and now he's going to run it. And he's out across the 40 to the 41-yard line. And our queen is Vicki Wilkinson. And I saw the night that they had the contest for the queens, and a former quarterback, Steve Fuller, who played for Clemson, was one of the judges, along with the head coach's wives. And I don't understand why they didn't have you as one of the judges.
And look at all the lovely princesses with her.
The ball now marked at the 43-yard line. Third down, a yard to go, and I don't know if he got it or not. Abercrombie trying to get up the field. Willie Underwood, the strong safety, filling very well for Clemson.
A hard man to knock off his feet. He has great leg strength. Take a look at it. You see the defense coming in. Bubba Brown, Reed, Underwood, Kennard, Jeff Davis, all of them just really swarming around the football.
A young man from Fort Payne, Alabama. We feel he could be a very strong candidate for all ACC honors next year.
See if they pick up enough for the first down.
So Baylor with an important first down. 7.5 minutes left in this game. Gary Helzer now is in at left guard for Baylor. Senior from Fort Worth, Texas, who can also play center. Mark Kirchner is playing right guard as he's been in there most of the game for Bill Glass, who had that bad ankle. Glass, the All-Southwest Conference pick. Elam on the option. Back to Gentry. Well, they're not playing it very cautious right now. Despite that lead, they're pitching the ball. They've acted as though they want to throw it as Bubba Brown, filling from the right linebacker spot, made the tackle. There's Gentry. He's not big for a fullback. He weighs 181.
That's Gentry?
No. I think the Tiger like to turn things upside down and get it righted again. Grant Taft, 46 years old. He feels this football team is so much better than that 74 Cotton Bowl team. And he thought his 3-8 team was better than that team that went to the Cotton Bowl, showing you the improvement in the Southwest Conference. Elam. Headed receiver Abercrombie as Bubba Brown had a hand on it, and that ball was close to being intercepted.
Boy, it was a big turnover. Really inspire this Clemson team right now.
Bubba Brown's been all over the place, hasn't he?
He has. I was kind of surprised they put it up that way because he threw down the field in a crowd.
So it's third down, 8 yards. Mitchell comes back in for Baylor. Bubba Brown only weighs 210, but they say he might be the hardest hitting man for his size in the country. Elam now 4 of 10 passing for 93 yards. He hits Mitchell. And Mitchell will not get the first down. He's to the 50, and that'll bring up fourth down. Rex Varn, Terry Kennard over to make the tackle. And so Stowe will come in and kick.
The clock trailing 14 points. The clock is really becoming a factor for Clemson right now. They need a big play offensively. They need a big return, something to happen offensively to get back into the football game.
Look at the average on Ron Stowe, over 46-yard average. Kicking from the 35. He hits another beauty. Hollis Hall calls for the fair catch, lets it hit, and that ball goes out of bounds at the 7-yard line. 43-yard kick. And the Tigers have a long ways to go from their own 7-yard line. Sweet Georgia Brown. At the 7-yard line, Clemson with the ball, and we want to take this opportunity to thank some of the Peach Bowl people, and we'll do that right after this play. In particular, the executive director, George Crumby. What a job he has done. Lott wanting to throw. He's going for all of it. Joey Smith, the intended receiver, and intercepted by Vines. Vic Vines picks it off for Baylor.
Boy, he played it perfectly. He anticipated that they were going to try to go long. You see the pump fake. He does get good pass protection, steps up, lets it fly, but you see the great position that Vic Vines has, and he makes the interception.
Well, we mentioned George Crumby, the executive director, the chairman of the festival division, Albert Tarica. Halftime coordinator, Dr. Ellis Mills.
NITV hospitality chairman, don't forget him, Chris Barberry. The chairman of the business community luncheon, Bill Zieberts.
Thank you, gentlemen. And so Baylor now sitting on this lead, gives off to Dennis Gentry out of Lubbock, Texas. 5'9", 181-pound sophomore. Ray Brown making the stop. I want to thank our statistician for his job.
Want to take him back? Where's from DeMarcus?
Penalty against the Baylor Bears.
We'll go 15 from here.
Bauer explaining the option.
Five.
10. It'll be a 15-yarder.
15. Illegal use of the hands. 51 offense. First down. First down.
So Raymond Bauer on the holding call, moving the ball back to the 30-yard line. 6 minutes. Elam on the option. He's straightened up. He's taking some punishment in this game. Steve Durham that time leading the charge. And so inside 6 minutes to go in this game. Baylor, who lost all four of their games this year to top 10 ranked teams. Bubba Brown, 47, Jim Stuckey on that picture. That is really remarkable. Second down, about 18 yards to go for Baylor. Abercrombie, he makes it to about the 35-yard line. And so it's going to come to a third down and still about 15, 16 yards to go. Well, you look at this Clemson team. They have 7 freshmen on defense, 6 freshmen on offense, and they're top 44 people. So you know they're going to be a pretty good football team next year.
And this was their rebuilding year.
And Baylor, don't forget about them, the people they're going to have returning. Gentry is one of them. Gentry fumbled the football, and Clemson has recovered. So with 4:45, the Tigers are still hanging on.
Jeff Davis, the man over there that got on the football for the Clemson Tigers. They'll have the ball at the 37. Boy, Gentry getting pounded pretty good that time.
Well, he did, and they have an opportunity right here to come up with a big play. 4:45 left in the football game.
This is Sims, a big fullback. Marvin Sims, and I don't believe he's carried the ball hardly at all today, and the big guy rambles forward. That was only his second carry of the game.
A good call this time, going to the draw play, because obviously Baylor had to be expecting the pass.
And there's a look at Marvin Sims. First down, the ball at the 26-yard line. Lott has his man and not able to hang on to Joey Smith. Ken Griffin hit him. Griffin's been all over the place.
Well, he made a good throw that time. He had the ball there. Smith just couldn't quite hang on to it. He made a good throw. Watch Billy Lott rolling left under some pressure from behind. You see right here, ball could have been caught.
Young freshman out of Newport News, Virginia. He was an All-American in track. Great speed, and the young man could not hang on, and it brings up second and 10 from the 26-yard line. 4:17 remaining. Baylor leading it 24-10, but the Tigers trying to climb back in it. Headed receiver is Clifford, the tight end. That play was very well covered.
That play was very well covered, but you have to give Andy Mellitry a lot of credit that time, because he forces Billy Lott to throw the football before he wants to let it go. You see him coming around, setting up, and you see Mellitry coming in. Ball overthrown, but he had to deliver the football before he wanted to. Third and 10, they need a play right here. They have to come away from this drive with a touchdown.
Smith, wide receiver, the top of the screen. Lott rolling, hits Clifford, the tight end. That will not be enough for the first down. Doak Field knocks him out of bounds. And so it comes to a fourth down and still 5 yards to go.
He took the man underneath this time because Baylor was giving him the short receiver, hoping that he could break a tackle and get the first down, but they're going to come up fourth and about five.
And so fourth down, five, and if Clemson figures on pulling this game out, they've got to get it right here. They've got to get at least the first down. 3.5 minutes left. Lott, and he has his man on the far side. That's Galliard, and that will be enough for the first down. A pressure-packed throw that time by Billy Lott.
Boy, good concentration by Galliard. The ball comes up a little short. Lott rolling to his right again. They got the ball to the left by the other throw, giving them the opportunity to roll out to the right. He throws it low to Galliard. No chance for the interception, and they get a first down. Clemson is still alive
at the 11-yard line. Lott in the corner for Tuttle. Tuttle being defended by Thomas Earl Young, who earlier had an interception. Tuttle still hasn't reappeared as he went into the corner. Is he shaken up? Now he's coming back very slowly.
Made a good throw that time to overthrow him, make sure he avoided the interception. Plenty of time left. 3:07 left in the game. 24-10. Baylor leading Clemson.
So Tuttle this time will go to the bottom of the screen. And now they have in Frank Magwood, a freshman, who's put to the top. Second down, Lott with pressure. Doak Field. Also Ronaldo, 59. And Lott has really hammered that time. A loss to the 19-yard line.
Everybody came. They had the blitz on. Ronaldo coming in. Doak Field. A lot of people around the football. No time for Billy Lott to set himself to throw the football.
At the 19, it will bring up third down, 18 yards to go for the Tigers. Galliard, Tuttle to the bottom of the screen, split out. Sim in the backfield along with McSwain, and a timeout now is called by Baylor. Baylor gets the timeout. And so with 2:32 left to be played in this game, the Tigers of Clemson trailing 24-10, trying desperately to get back on the scoreboard.
That's a night that the lights went out in Georgia.
There's the situation, 2:32 remaining, as we have a third down, 18 yards to go for Clemson. They trail it 24-10. What? Trying to hit Galliard. He did not see the football. Griffin defending on the play. The timing off on that one.
Yes, he was, Nick, coming up with another fourth down play.
Tommy Tabor put some pretty good pressure on from his tackle spot. And so earlier, the Tigers converted on a fourth down, and it comes to that again. This time it's fourth down, 18 yards to go.
They can get a first down inside of the one-yard line.
And now we have another timeout, this one called by the Tigers, as Billy Lott will go over to visit with Danny Ford. As Clemson has had some opportunities, they've thrown two interceptions in this second half of play. Lott in this game is 16 of 32. Let's really say something nice about Bob Rowe and Jim Selman. It's been a pleasure, hasn't it?
I've enjoyed the whole year with both of them, and they've made that job a lot easier, and we thank them.
And we wish them a happy new year.
It wouldn't have been possible.
Not too bad, those two guys. They kept you out of a lot of trouble. 2:28 left in this game as Tigers now with their last-ditch effort once again to make things stay alive for them. You look at this Baylor team, they have a lot of young players back. One guy in particular, Singletary, still has another year. They have both their linebackers back. They have Campbell back. They will lose Mellentree and Brown, their defensive ends. Their secondary, they will have one of them returning, a starter, Van McElroy. Offensively, they'll lose one guard and both tackles along with a wide receiver. So there's going to be some rebuilding for Baylor, but they have some key people coming back. Fourth and 18 in motion. Tuttle, Lott, and he almost had his head taken off by Tommy Tabor. Boy, did he get hit.
He got hit. He
was also there.
He's still down. He's a tough young man. Shows a lot of courage throughout the day because he's been under a lot of pressure. And you see those defensive tackles from that 4-3 defense shooting in that time and making the play and sacking Billy Lott.
Lott, by the way, is quite a baseball player. He had an offer from the New York Mets. He's a catcher in baseball. And now at the 30-yard line, Baylor has a 2:21 remaining, and they have a 24-10 lead. Steve Smith is the new quarterback. He gives off to Frank Pollard. Smith was the guy that was the man who started 10 games in 1978 for Baylor. Tomorrow, carry that time by Pollard, and Pollard is able to move the football just about back to the original line of scrimmage, and that's all. Boy, I know this young man was glad to see some postseason action after being out with a broken jaw. Chance to finish the year in good shape.
The Baylor Bears, you have to give them a lot of credit for what they did today with the football against this very tough Clemson Tiger defensive team, and the fact that they made big plays. That has been the difference in this football game, the big plays made by the Baylor offense.
On a third and 10, Steve Smith having some trouble hanging on to the football, senior from El Paso. Steve Durham there instantly, and Baylor's going to have to kick the football. Inside a minute to go.
And the clock is running. I'd like to take this opportunity, Gary, to say thank you to you. I've enjoyed working with you throughout the NFL season and for this 12th annual Peach Bowl. Happy New Year.
Same to you, buddy. I tell you, I've enjoyed this year as much as any of the years I've ever been in this business. And it's going to be a very happy New Year's for this Baylor football team and Grant Taft and his outstanding staff. But also, we can't say enough for Clemson. They have a delay of game against Baylor. They run the clock down 25 seconds in college, and the delay of game, the 5-yard penalty. And Stowe back to kick inside the 10. Hollis Hall, the only man back, a big rush, and it's blocked. It is blocked. And the ball is going to be inside the 5-yard line. They're going to mark it at about the 1, it appears. That's James Robinson, 75.
Well, you take a look at this. This team's never ready to quit. Oh, what a great play that time. Ball rolling loose. James Robinson picks it up right at the goal line.
Well, we have the MVP on offense and defense just announced at the Peach Bowl. It's Mickey Elam for Baylor. And the defensive player, Andrew Mellentree, the Baylor defensive end.
Well, he had an outstanding day. Both men did. You have to give Mickey Elam a lot of credit coming in with Brannon being injured at the end of the first half and coming in and doing the job he's done in the second half for Baylor.
So the Tigers would like to salve some wounds here and take this in. A give to Chuck McSwain, and he's in. McSwain takes it in. So the block punt and the follow-up touchdown.
Well, you see McSwain going in off the right side, getting the touchdown, being set up by the block punt.
24-16. You're going to hear a lot from McSwain, just the freshman. He had 120 yards earlier this year against Duke, the ACC Rookie of the Year. So the point after attempt coming up, and they're going to go for two. They'll go for two, 24-16 with 20 seconds left in this game. Billy Lott, and he has his man Jeff McCall, who's another freshman. And McCall has a two-point conversion, 24-18.
Again, the roll to the left, and he makes a good throw again. You notice, well, you just can't give them enough credit for coming back and playing the way they have and never giving up.
Let me tell you something. They're going to try an onside kick now, Mr. Jurgensen, and they're down by 6 points. Stranger things have happened, huh?
Stranger things have happened. Yes, they have.
And you know why they went for two. And so with 20 seconds, we'll have an onside kick coming up. Now, if they would get on that football, they have a last-ditch effort. And they could still pull this game out. Now, the Tiger does a push-up for every point they score. And we were mentioning earlier, they scored 55 points in one game, and he was exhausted after that one was over. There we go on the onside kick. Arere will be doing the honors, and everybody is up close for the Baylor Bears. We said the MVP offensively is Mickey Elam.
Congratulations, Mickey. What a fine day he's had. He's going to be happy.
Everybody on their feet. A lot of people left this game, and it's not over until we determine what this play developed. Look at him now, jumping around. Arere kicking it, and it's still open at Baylor. Let's see, Clemson may have it. They do. The Tigers have it. With 19 seconds left, they're down by 6 points.
That's what you call execution. Got everybody over here on this side of the field, and they executed the onside kick.
They already have a play called. Clemson ready to run it. Jamie Pope was the man who got on the football.
We said we were going to have a great football game, and that we have.
19 seconds left. The ball is at the 46-yard line. Billy Lott trying to pull it out. Throws up the field. Tuttle's got it. He is at the 33. And the Tigers will ask for a timeout, I believe. Nope. They'll have the clock stop with the first down. And so it stopped with 12 seconds. They'll set it back into play. at the 33-yard line. First down. They wait for the chain gang before they start the clock, and he's going to kill the clock now. And a flag. Now, wait a minute. What's that all about? We may have... I'm not even going to guess.
You're going to get intentional grounding, aren't you?
Well, I'm surprised that they would call that.
He didn't have a receiver out there. There was no receiver.
Illegal pass, intentionally grounded. Blocking that. There was nobody over those times.
You know, we don't see that very often in the NFL. You never really see that being enforced at all, do you?
There was no receiver to that side, and he was stopping the clock to that side. That's why the call.
That is a loss of down as well as a penalty. 9 seconds left. Lot back again. Intended for Tuttle. Intercepted. Picked off by Dope Field. And Baylor puts the lid on it. But it had to give him some shaky seconds. As this very, very game, Clemson Tiger football team scared him right down to the very end. As you see, 1 second remaining.
They had the answer every time they had to. They came up with a big play. Dope Field, Andy Mellentree, they made the big plays when they had to.
And Mellentree, of course, the MVP on defense. And so with 1 second left, don't forget the Cotton Bowl tomorrow, 2 o'clock Eastern time. Nebraska and the Cougars of Houston. Southwest Conference picking up a win here today, and they'd like to continue that on the first day of 1980.
I hope they have a fine football game as we've had here this afternoon.
And Mickey Elam falls on the football. And so the final score. The Baylor Bears defeating the Clemson Tigers 24-18. And so for Sonny Jurgensen, this is Gary Bender wishing you all a very happy new year and saying so long from the Peach Bowl in Atlanta, Georgia.
The 1979 Peach Bowl.
Let's talk about him. First of all, this afternoon against Clemson, we're talking, of course, about the Peach Bowl and Baylor's victory. The Bears were able to block two punts, and they turned both of those into touchdowns. Then they let quarterback Mickey Elam, the senior who got to play the entire second half after an injury to Mike Brannan, he unleashed a rarely seen passing attack from the Baylor Bears. And after falling behind 7-0 by the end of the first quarter, the Bears rallied and held on in the final few seconds. That we'll take a look at. The final score, 24-18, Baylor winning in the Peach Bowl. After moving down the field by a passing attack from Brannan to Radar Holt and some penalties, it finally comes down to this pass to Bowl Taylor for the touchdown at 7-7. David Sims not punting well all afternoon. It sets up Baylor deep in Clemson territory. Watch this. Brannan has to roll back to his right against the grain. Great blocking there by the offensive lineman. We have to see this one more time. A Hail Mary pass, but there is Radar Holt in the end zone. Watch it again. Just thrown up for everybody. Really, the only two people in contention there, Willie Underwood, the defensive back, and Holt comes down with it. Baylor defense great all day. Marvin Sims into the middle of the line. Mike Singletary, and the defensive player of the game, you can see right here why Billy Lott goes down in the hands of Andrew Mellentree. It was 14-7 at halftime, then Clemson closed it in with a 41-yard field goal. Abed Ariri makes it 14-10. Brannan was hurt with some stretched ligaments, so Mickey Elam played the entire second half. Watch this, throwing against the grain to Walter Abercrombie, who is going to scoop for 63 yards down the sidelines. He is finally hauled out of bounds by Rex Barn. Clemson then tightened up. Robert Bledsoe had to come in to kick the field goal, which he did. Baylor back out in front by 7. It was 17-10, and Mike Brannan watched the entire second half from the sideline after the injury, the stretched ligaments to the knees. On defense, we said it was Andrew Mellentree who was the defensive player of the game, but Dope Field, the linebacker, had an absolutely perfect afternoon. Watch as he traps Marvin Sims for a 7-yard loss. Looks absolutely great. Now then, the blocked punt.
Sort of make up for all the bad things that's wrong, but just trying to get a little bit harder than everybody else.
Well, it was your senior season, and you did a fantastic job all year long, and best of luck to you from now on.
Well, thank you, and
like I said, it is my last game, and I've had a very good year with the Baylor Bears, and I wanted to wish them all the success in the future years and future seasons. And, Hollywood Squares is next, so see you at 10. Good night.
A crowd of
supporters greeted the Peach Bowl champion Bears this morning at Madison Cooper Airport in Waco. It took the team about an hour and a half to make the nonstop flight from Atlanta, where yesterday they beat the Clemson
Tigers 24-18 in the 12th annual Peach Bowl. Walter Abercrombie was the man who emerged from the plane with the big prize, the Peach Bowl trophy. The players and Coach Grant Taft were greeted by cheers from the crowd and happily signed things for autograph seekers. The noise and crowd at the airport made it impossible to conduct interviews today, but yesterday, Glenn Diamond of WXIA-TV in Atlanta provided us with some post-game interviews.
Well, you know, it was two real fine football teams, a great game, and both teams were well prepared and played with a lot of enthusiasm. We have a tremendous amount of respect for Clemson. We think we're a good football team, and we know that they're a good football team. We were fortunate to win, but, you know, any time in a bowl game like this, if you win, you're probably fortunate because you're playing another good team.
Tell me exactly what this meant to Grant Taft today.
Well, it meant to me a lot because it was important to our team to win it for Kyle Woods.
You had two touchdown passes in the first half before you went away with the injury. Can you kind of describe them for me?
Well, the first one was a goal line route, and he made the good catch on it. Second one was more of a Hail Mary type pass, and Radar Hope made a good catch in the end zone on it, and it was more of a luck play than a skill play, but it worked out.
When they talk about winning a football game, coaches, players, they talk about the big play, and Walter Abercrombie was involved in one big one today.
That's right. Right at halftime, I got with Coach of mine and talked to him about throwing a throwback, a sprint out throwback pass, and that's sprinting out to one side and then throwing the ball back to the other side. And as well as Clemson's linebackers run, we thought maybe we could get them off balance and hit them back to the other side, and that's just exactly what we did. It worked perfect. Mickey threw the ball real well, and it just happened that nobody was over there, and I got a lot of yards up the sideline.
I was laying in my room last night and just flicked Channel 5 and heard that Clemson was a three-point favorite, you know. But I didn't see how, you know, after looking at them on film, I feel like we had a better offense than they did and definitely a better defense. And we proved it, you know, as team told, you know. Everyone was hitting, everyone was running hard, you know, great running backs, great defensive backs, and everything just turned out just the way we wanted it. And I like to personally say that I'm glad we gave Kyle something worthwhile.
The Kyle Andrew was talking about was, of course, Kyle Woods, the Baylor defensive back who injured his spine in practice just 1 week before the season started and is now undergoing treatment in Dallas for paralysis. Kyle was at the game and in the locker room when it was over. We
go from here.
Sports Director Alan Stone talked to Kyle about the game.
Okay, Kyle, it has to be a tremendous feeling after Baylor's won the Peach Bowl and to dedicate the win to you.
It really means a lot to me, you know, to travel this far and see them do so well, you know. I really appreciate it.
This is your first time to really travel at all since the injury.
Right, right. It was worth it, though.
Was the rehabilitation making progress up in Dallas? Do you feel better just overall?
Yeah, I feel a lot better. I know that I'm progressing, and I just hope I continue to.
You had a chance to watch the game from up in the press box, and that's the first game you've been at in person this year. How did it feel?
Felt pretty good. I went up in the press box because I got cold. So I came back out before the game and, you know, to see them finish it off.
Well, it was a great opportunity they had to end up the season where you could see it on New Year's Eve.
And national television, too. I liked it.
A great accomplishment for the 1979 Bears. They set some goals for the season and obtained them. Final goal, winning a bowl game for Kyle Woods.
Know about the four losses to top 10 teams, but of the seven outfits the Bears beat during the regular season, only one, Texas A&M, finished with a winning record. There were those who pointed this out, and they said that they doubted whether Baylor was deserving of a top 20 ranking. But New Year's Eve laid those doubts to rest. Clemson had a defense equivalent to Texas and Houston, but Baylor took full advantage of every opportunity the Tigers provided while reciprocating with very few mistakes of their own, well, at least until the last 30 seconds. So while the regular season showed that Baylor was perhaps not one of the 10 best teams in the country, the Peach Bowl on New Year's Eve certified they were certainly among the 15 best. A final note, Peach Bowl most valuable offensive player Mike Brannon underwent surgery this morning in Waco for torn knee ligaments. Those were suffered late in the first half of that game. Doctors termed the operation successful, and while Brannon will miss spring training this year, he should be full speed by 2-a-days next August. And we'll be back with more sports after this.
They did have that tie earlier in the year with California. Bottom half of the top 10, Pittsburgh, Nebraska, Florida State, Arkansas, and Purdue. Arkansas and Houston, the two top 10 teams from the Southwest Conference. The bottom 10 of the top 20, Washington, Brigham Young, Texas, North Carolina. And for the first time since they were in the top 20 back in 1975 after the Cotton Bowl, Baylor, a member of the top 20, number 15 for the UPI, number 14 for the Associated Press. They rounded out. We have Indiana, Temple, Penn State.
Defensive tackle Gary Don Johnson will all be participating in the annual East-West Shrine Game this Saturday. Glass and Johnson will be in the North-South game the following week, while Thompson will journey to Tokyo for the second annual Japan Bowl. Well, with all the football, basketball's had to take a back seat.
Two quarterbacks and three different receivers, Raymond Cockrell and Mick Elam on the rollout action. In the end, Clemson had 20 seconds to pull the game out, but they fell short, lost to Baylor in the Peach Bowl 24-18. Down 10-7 to Houston, Nebraska pulled the old halfback from quarterback back to quarterback play. It winds up in the hands of Jeff Quinn. Then Quinn drops back to pass and hits Jeff Finn, his backup tight end behind Junior Miller. In the end zone, touchdown 14-10, but they love that in Houston. Here's Terry Elston, the quarterback. He throws this one to Eric Herring there at the 9-yard line. It's desperation time, 19 seconds left, 4th down and 6. Elston finds Herring again on the tip. Watch it one more time. End zone, slow motion, unbelievable end to the game. If you saw it, you know what it was like. Houston 17, Nebraska 14. Knee surgery to Baylor quarterback Mike Brannan is reported to have been a success today. Brannan stretched ligaments in his knee, his left knee, during the Peach Bowl game played out in Atlanta. He was unable to come back during the second half. He was operated on this morning in Waco. The injury will keep Mike out of spring training, but that is typical for that type of injury. He is reported to be doing fairly well. More sports.